Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting in 2021 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee, and I'd like to thank Daniel for chairing the pre-briefing session. We're meeting remotely today and have a single item on our agenda which involves taking evidence from two panels of witnesses as part of our scrutiny of the Scottish Budget 22-23. First of all, we hear from the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body on its own budget bid, and then we'll take evidence on the Scottish Budget 2022-23 from Kate Forbes, Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy. And then move to our first panel of witnesses, Jackson Carlow, MSP, the SPCB Lead on Governance Issues, who is joined today by Scottish Parliamentary officials, David McGill, Chief Executive, Michelle Hegarty, the Deputy Chief Executive, and Sarah Glass, Group Head of Financial Governance. We've around an hour for this discussion, and we should direct questions to Mr. Carlow in the first instance, and where he'd prefer for an official to respond to a question, I'd ask that he makes this clear to the broadcasting team to operate the microphones. I remind members that broadcasting will also operate their mics and that they should allow a few moments before speaking to ensure they will be heard. I plan to bring members in to speak in the order we discussed earlier, but if anyone would like to come in, perhaps following up another member's question, please type R into the chat function. And I open up the question to members' questions, and I'd like to begin by asking Jackson that in terms of the document that we've all been provided with, in paragraph 9, it says, and I quote, that greater scrutiny capacity within the existing committee structure was needed to address the substantial increase in committee workloads arising from the impact of Brexit. And the following paragraph then goes on to say that additional staffing investment in respect of Brexit-related scrutiny has been provided over the preceding 3 years. I'm just wondering what the level of this is and the cost implications of that going forward.
Thank you, convener. I would ordinarily have made an opening statement. Were you expecting me to do that just on behalf
of the— No, I wasn't expecting you to do that, actually, to be honest. But if you would like to make an opening statement, I'd be more than happy to do that. I was quite surprised there wasn't one, but if you'd like to go back a step and have an opening statement, I'd be more than happy to take that.
Well, thank you, convener, because any time I've presented before, that's what we've done. I think it's helpful just to set out the main themes of the budget. So thank you, convener. Thank you for the invitation to us to be here this morning, and as you've said, joined by David McGill, Michelle Hegarty and Sarah Glass as well. In this first budget of the new session, the corporate body is following up its commitment given in February 21 to the then convener of the Finance and Constitution Committee that we would undertake a review of staffing resources to ensure a more robust and sustainable baseline for Session 6. This request was echoed in legacy reports from other committees, as well as from a large number of members from across all the parties in the Chamber during a debate around this time last year. And it follows on from the review of member staff costs as well. Accordingly, this bid, based on robust analysis and planning, addresses our capability and capacity to support the work of members of Parliament across the session. Following this proposed investment, we intend to steward our resources, managing pressures and uncertainties for the duration of the session. Now, unfortunately, many uncertainties do persist, most notably the ongoing pandemic, which has placed significant challenge on how we operate and on our financial resources. However, the committee can be assured that the SPCB will continue, as it has throughout the last 20 months, to responsibly flex our resources to meet the demands placed upon us, and this remains our COVID assumption for the upcoming budget. Turning then to the proposed budget for 2022-23, excluding capital charges and non-cash items, it represents a net 1.4 increase on the current financial year's budget, which was itself a higher budget, largely because of the Scottish elections for which the Parliament is responsible. For the committee's purposes, it's a 3.8% increase than the indicative budget that was for 2022-23 previously presented. And now, this is primarily attributable to three factors. One, the strategic review of SPCB staffing baseline for Session 6, to which I've just referred. Secondly, to anticipated requirements for members' personal security. And thirdly, for inflationary increases for the Parliament's running costs. Following the death of Sir David Amos, the corporate body has been reviewing the personal security support provided to members. The corporate body is currently progressing a number of initiatives, but until the requirements and projected uptake from members are clearer, it's our view that a prudent approach is to create provision and contingency for this year, with actual financial amounts being baselined the following year. And the committee will be well aware that inflation is now highly volatile, the third area to which I referred, The forecasters predicting continued high levels in the medium term, inflation impacts across all aspects of the corporate body cost base, and the current levels are driving cost increases ahead of those forecasts when we prepared the indicative budget previously. And this additional pressure is also captured in our budget bid for operational costs. For MSPs and ministerial salaries, I can confirm that following the 0% increase in 21-22, the SPC's budget bid reflects a 3.4% uplift, consistent with the application of the ASH index as laid out in the member salary scheme. The staff cost provision uplift, using agreed indices, will be 4.5%. This effectively is a provision of £139,200 per member for employing staff. Turning to running costs, the corporate body proposed to maintain a broadly similar level of investment. This includes projects to sustain our building facilities, infrastructure and services. The pace of change in our operations is faster than it's ever been, as illustrated in the last 18 months by the addition of two new technology-dependent services, the hybrid parliamentary business platform and remote voting, on which you may wish to ask questions. We will continue to develop and support services to provide a secure, effective working environment online, at Holyrood and in local offices. Convener, if you are agreeable, I would have liked David McGill, the Chief Executive, and Clark, just to conclude the opening remarks with a brief overview of this staffing baseline bid that I think you then might want to ask questions about.
Yes, happy to do that, Jackson.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to just give you a little bit more detail on what has driven our response to the request for a review of parliamentary resources to alleviate the pressures on members and Parliament. So members are well aware that the post-EU operating environment has made the devolution settlement hugely more complex. Whereas before there was a relatively readily understandable picture of reserved and devolved matters, policy is now developed in the context of the UK internal market, common frameworks, the Scottish Government's keeping pace power, and the ability or desire to align or diverge from EU policy by either government. Added to this is the increased ability of the UK government to legislate in devolved areas and the need for regulation in areas that were previously regulated by the EU. All of this is leading to increased demand from committees for support on legal and procedural aspects of the policy development and scrutiny rules, as was evidenced in a number of committee legacy reports at the end of last session and a chamber debate this time last year. On the wider issue of the effectiveness of our parliamentary committees, we've just established what I would describe as the most ambitious set of committees ever. As this committee is well aware, we've added public administration as an explicit aspect of committee scrutiny. But we've also separated out civil and criminal justice, we've added civic participation to Jackson Carlow's committee, and we've retained the COVID-19 committee for the duration of this session. This ambitious framework will require to be supported by professional expertise in SPICE, clerking and legal services. Alongside this, the Conveners Group is taking a more strategic role to parliamentary scrutiny of the government in relation to matters such as collaboration between the committees, diversity and inclusion in committee work, and post-legislative scrutiny. And I'm also conscious that the government, which we are tasked with holding to account, has grown considerably in size since new powers were given to Scottish ministers and the Parliament from 2016. And we're also keen to deliver a step change in relation to public involvement in the work of committees. Demand from committees for greater public engagement rose considerably over session 5, and we're committed to making further improvements that will enhance the quality of parliamentary scrutiny. Finally, there are significant expectations around the Parliament's leadership in embedding sustainability and progressing our roadmap to net zero. From a scrutiny perspective, achieving net zero brings huge challenges across all policy areas. The Scottish Government has established a net zero directorate, a just transition minister, a cabinet subcommittee, all of which requires a commensurate response from the Parliament to ensure that we're delivering the scrutiny of increased government activity in this area. So all of this is, in short, what has led to the bid for increased resources that we're presenting to you today. I'm happy to expand on any of that, and the panel is content to answer questions on the overall SPCB budget bid for 2022-23.
Okay, thank you for that, David. And I won't repeat the questions that I asked earlier on, because it leads on to another similar question, which is at paragraph 21, where you say the bid states that the SPCB is committed to enhancing the scrutiny function of Parliament, including promoting citizen participation to enable legislature and the members to perform their roles. And you again talk about the scrutiny challenges arising from Brexit, but you also say that these complex issues will create significant ongoing scrutiny challenges for the Parliament and its committees throughout Session 6. We now need to move towards a more stable and sustainable staffing structure to best support scrutiny in this new, more complex environment. And that's what yourself and Jackson have obviously touched on. And you also went on to talk about the huge challenge of net zero. So just for the record, can you say, first of all, how long you expect the kind of Brexit scrutiny uplift in terms of workload to last? Throughout Session 6, but will it peak at any point, or will it continue at the same level and go beyond that? And also, how do we quantify the huge challenge of monitoring net zero? And again, how do we quantify that in terms of the additional staff required to assist MSPs with that work?
Two important areas there. It is, I think, difficult to be, like anything, certain about the long-term requirement in terms of the scrutiny of issues arising from Brexit. We have modelled this as best we can, and David will touch on that as well. And on net zero, similarly, but we have got quite a sort of sustained action plan on net zero. I'm not sure if you're talking about the scrutiny in relation to net zero or our own scrutiny of ourselves in relation to what we are doing to achieve net zero, but Michelle will certainly be able to expand in detail on that. But in the first instance, with your permission, convener, I would ask David to comment on the Brexit aspect of the question.
Thank you. Yeah, I would say that in terms of the peak, I think we're probably now at the position where we've gone beyond transition, clearly. But what we're seeking to do now is to stabilise in this new operating environment. So I don't necessarily see this being a peak which will then tail off now. We've moved into that post-EU environment, and what we're looking for now is the resources that we're going to have to manage in that environment. And just to give you one example, in relation to scrutiny of subordinate legislation, we're now seeing a sustained level of round about a 50% increase in the number of statutory instruments that the Parliament is required to scrutinise, as we did pre-Brexit. And this is because of that need for regulation to happen in Scotland and at UK level rather than at the EU level. So I think what we're looking at now is that more stable picture. So it's gone beyond peaks and troughs, and we're entering into that new operating environment. I'll hand over to Michelle now to pick up on the issue around about net zero.
Good morning, committee members. I was going to pick up on net zero. There's two aspects, I think, as Jackson alluded to here. The first is our own staffing capability and support to members and to committees in terms of scrutiny of others and the government in particular, and how it addresses net zero and the ambitions around climate change. So some of that is factored into the staffing bid, particularly in terms of the sort of parliamentary business side of the organisation, but we've also made an investment in the environmental skills that we have in the organisation as well. Some of that's going to support us in our own ambitions around net zero and how we hold ourselves to account on achieving some of those targets. The corporate body has already got a carbon management plan which sets out how it's going to reduce emissions by 66% by 2026. And some of that is going to be project spend, which features as part of our project budget this year. In addition to that, we are also undertaking a degree of learning and development for ourselves as officials whenever it comes to looking at the sustainability of some of our investment decisions, ways in which we run the parliamentary state, and how we undertake projects, contract relets, things like that as well. So there's a number of bodies involved here. The corporate body is obviously going to be responsible for establishing the net zero plan for the Parliament, and it will be engaging with that in the new year. Officials obviously have a role in advising members, and we also have a role in running the Parliament. The Conveners Group also set themselves a strategic priority around sustainable development, which we will seek to support. And obviously, one of the places where we expect that we will be held to account for the SPCP's plans is also through the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee as well.
Okay, it's just that, I mean, I asked a specific question about how this is being quantified, because the budget bid is very specific in terms of the bid, you know, £112.161 million. And if there's additional staff being required to either look at net zero or look at Brexit, or indeed the committee scrutiny or strength of committees, it would be helpful just to know, you know, how much actually was either in staff numbers or indeed the budget, the additional budget required for those.
Well, I mean, I think, Convener, we actually do have an understanding of what the increase in staff numbers are. We've had a number of part-time staff, obviously, and a number of people who've been employed on a temporary basis. But in terms of the overall number, again, David would be, if I bring David in, we'll be able to give you a detailed view of the actual increase in staffing, if that would be helpful.
Yeah, it's just for the record, really. Thanks, David.
Yeah, happy to do that. The overall figure that we're seeking to pursue through this budget bid is a gross increase of 46 members of staff. That includes the 13 temporary staff that we've been operating with for some time now, and that was a figure that was sponsored by the corporate body and agreed by the predecessor committee. So moving beyond that, we're looking at that stabilisation figure of an additional 33 permanent posts above the current year figure. That breaks down to about a 6% increase in the staffing budget for the year. And just to give you a further breakdown, we know exactly where these staff are going. So of that 46, 21, for example, will be in the Parliament Scrutiny Group. And that's a group that consists of the committee office, Vice, and the public, the participation and communities team. 10 staff would be in BIT, 8 staff would be in the parliamentary, the legislation and parliamentary business team. So we've done a very detailed exercise about where the actual.
Okay, that's very helpful. And that takes us up to 625, is that correct?
I had an interruption here. Yeah, we've conducted under Treasury Green Book rules for the processes for composing business cases. So each of the areas of the Parliament that's led by a group head was asked to submit a detailed business case with options appraisals. And that's how we fleshed out exactly where the demands were for individual staff increases.
Okay, now saying that takes us up to a complement about 625, is that correct, David?
That's correct. I mean, I think on full-time equivalent is around about 600, but yeah, on headcount it's slightly over the 600 mark, yeah.
Yeah, okay. It's just, the reason I was asking these is just so that people, you know, it can get this kind of into perspective. It's always good to have numbers, I believe. Moving on to paragraph 12, staff cost provision increased in session 6 from 93,000 to 133,000. Jackson has advised that it's got up to 139,200. And for comparison, the MPs this current year are £177,500. I'm just wondering what the utilisation has been of the increase from 93,000 to 133,000. I realise they haven't completed financial year, but obviously there must be some indication as to what the uplift of that has been.
I mean, I think that's a difficult question to answer at this stage, Convener, because in the first year of a new Parliament, particularly with new members, the actual time it takes to engage staff is quite considerable. I mean, there will be new members as members of this committee, possibly, who haven't yet fulfilled their staff commitment or who took several months to do so. So I think there will be probably an underspend in the first year, simply because members will have been recruiting staff and will have had start dates, some of which may only have been in the autumn. And so we'll probably not have a full answer on that until the following year. But Michelle obviously is monitoring these things, and with your permission, I think we'll be able to give you an indication. I think we're probably sitting at about, typically in other parliaments, about 4/5 of capacity in terms of utilisation. But Michelle can probably give some further confirmation. Michelle?
Yes. Yes, convener, we're about 80% recruitment now, but we do see a little bit of churn in that, obviously, especially where members are setting up their offices. And we've still got some members to set up offices, and as Jackson's alluded to, we've still got some members here seeking to undertake recruitment, but we are about 80% at the moment in terms of recruitment. We'll start to see that settle down. One of the things that we have with the corporate body been keeping an eye on is obviously also office cost provision, because members are employing more staff. But again, it's too early to tell if there's any issues with that either.
Okay, might be a couple of years before we can really analyse that in any great depth. But one thing actually I was going to ask about, Jackson, you and I were both list MSPs before being elected constituency MSPs. Yeah. I'm sure you'll agree that in terms of workload, there is absolutely no comparison. So I'm just wondering for how much longer will the SPCB pretend that there's no difference in workloads between the list and constituency members, and will future assessments of staffing costs consider that reality?
Thank you for that question, convener. Yes, as you say, I have been both a regional and a constituency member. And I noticed a very considerable change in the nature of my workload, moving from one of those functions to the other. But I also acknowledge that the overall responsibilities of the Parliament have changed significantly since I was a regional member, with the additional fiscal powers that the Scottish Government has got, and therefore the additional responsibilities that have devolved on us. And I personally am now maybe less convinced of the variance in the workload between regional and constituency members. I think that there is a variance in the nature of the workload. But I know from the work that we did as a corporate body, liaising with members across the Parliament in the whole COVID period, that the increase in the workload and demands of all members as a result of the pandemic was very, very considerable. I think as people discovered Zoom, as people discovered the whole nature of online inquiry, I think there's been a considerable increase in the way in which people have been approaching us and in the volume of that approach. But I think it's also important to say that there is an obligation in that the entire scheme under which we operate has at its heart a principle of equality between all members of the Parliament. So it is absolutely, I think, fundamentally important, notwithstanding the way in which workloads may have evolved to where they are today, that all members of the Scottish Parliament are equal and are treated as such.
Very diplomatically put, Jackson. I'll just move on to my last question, which is with regard to the £1 million contingency for enhanced security support to members. I realise that prudent assumptions have been made on this. Now, this works out at just under £8,000 each. I'm just wondering what indications you have of uptake in that. I know it's relatively early days, but I certainly won't go anything like it got to that level. I'm just wondering if what the SPC information is at this point.
Well, we've undertaken an initial survey of members, which is out just now, which will be one of the things that will help quantify that. But when we get to a certain stage in the rollout, it may well be that members will take advantage of the opportunity to have a survey as appropriate undertaken of domestic premises or whatever, with recommendations, some of which, just as was the case with office security assessments, they may wish to take up or they may not wish to take up. There are various different streams that we are currently exploring. There are a number of technical challenges, there are a number of fiscal challenges, taxation challenges that we're just having to liaise with representatives from other parliaments on. But there are a number of different streams that we are investigating in relation to member security. And the best we can do, I think, is come up with the contingency that we have, which we will obviously have a far better understanding of in the course of the next 12 months, because that will be when these costs actually quantify. I'm not sure if Michelle can add anything further to that. I'm pretty sure that's more or less summing up the position.
No, that's absolutely comprehensive, Jackson, and we expect the corporate body. We are moving at pace as officials on trying to understand, as Jackson says, the need from members and also how that might be resourced. And we would expect to return to this in the early new year with the corporate body. And as Jackson says, that will help inform what plans need to get taken forward based on members' feedback and how that would be resourced. And we'll be much better placed, I think, come the next budgeting round to really understand how that's baselined.
OK, well, thank you very much for that. I'm going to open out the session to colleagues. And the first member to ask questions about this to be followed by John.
Convener, and one of which actually follows on from that last one regarding personal security. Can I just get some clarity on the timescale for which the SPCB will be wanting feedback from members following advice from local visits of police, as we were instructed to do or requested to do? When do you expect to get a good idea from the members of the Scottish Parliament what home security they might be requiring? What's the timescale for that?
Other than as Michelle says, can you hear me, Liz? Sorry, I'm not actually sure if I'm, oh yeah, right, sorry. Yeah. Other than as Michelle says, we are moving at pace. We don't actually get, no, I mean, we're going to get recommendations made and then requests following that. We're looking, for example, to see whether there should be any kind of national procurement, to make these issues easier. That may or may not be the route to go. So there are a series of questions that we are currently exploring and investigating, taking advice from others who are going through a similar exercise, whether at Westminster in Northern Ireland or in Wales. But clearly, there is a sense of urgency in relation to all of this, in terms of the reassurance that we want members to have. And so as and when we are able to make early progress, you can be assured that's what we'll be doing.
I think that would be very helpful, actually, because I think there are members who want to get a little bit more guidance following some what I think the SPCB has done a very good job on this, and I think it was a very sensible recommendation for the rest of us to contact local police, etc., and for home visits. And I think there are also members who would like just to be able to feedback on that and ensure that the SPCB can help them with some of these costs, hopefully in the not too distant future. My other question, obviously, you have both, well, three of you have highlighted some very considerable extra expenses that the Parliament's having to cope with, whether that's staff costs or it's security costs or it's ongoing inflation, etc. There will be some savings, or there are some savings, I can see from the numbers. What processes are there for the SPCB to estimate the changes on savings that will come about because of our changed working practices? For example, members like myself, our travel expenses over the period of COVID were not as extensive as they had been before because we were able to work at home, etc., and same for our staff. What projections or what processes are there for the SPCB to be able to project whether the change to working practices will actually be quite permanent and therefore some savings will accrue from that? And how can that be worked out?
Well, I'll come to colleagues in a moment, but I fully understand and appreciate the question. Again, I think it is quite difficult to be absolutely certain about this. Clearly, there has been a requirement for people to work at home for a large part of the pandemic. And as we move forward, that may vary in a number of different ways. We are acutely conscious, not just of keeping people safe, but also of people's mental health and well-being. And we're aware that it may well be that while some staff will continue to work remotely. They may choose to work remotely from constituency offices in order that they are in with a smaller community, but therefore engaging with others. And that in itself might change the nature of the parliamentary function of constituency offices, requiring them to be a more obvious extension of the parliamentary process in terms of the ability to engage reliably from constituency offices as we go forward. We know that there are clearly a considerable number of members who prefer to be at Parliament if they can be. Then, as I think we saw in a quite excellent debate in the Parliament last week, ahead of a committee inquiry into future working practices on the back of the hybrid arrangements that we have experienced, it may well be that there are members who go forward on a variable basis, which is that they work remotely when they don't need to be in Parliament, or are in therefore in Parliament more regularly when they have a particular and physical need to be present. So I think we're going to be monitoring all of this as we go along. We obviously also, I want to applaud the work that the Parliament has done on the hybrid working that we've got. Now, that's not to say I don't understand the frustrations. I can see my own party's WhatsApp chat line as we navigate our way through the hybrid working process at times. And the Parliament is still looking at ways in which we can make that more robust and extend the functionality of that hybrid working. One of the big frustrations being our inability at present to intervene, for example, in hybrid contributions. Michelle, again, I think probably could take forward some of what I'm saying in a bit more detail in terms of any process that the officials are monitoring on the themes I've just discussed.
Yes, I suppose there's two parts, really, well, maybe even three parts to this answer. The first is the last 20 months have taught us a lot in managing COVID within our existing budget. And so one of the things I think that the member picked up on was that there may be savings in certain aspects of the corporate body's budget, but that is counteracted by increased costs in other aspects of the budget. So, for example, yes, travel, for example, we have seen in the last 20 months a drop off in travel costs. We've also seen, unfortunately, a reduced footfall at Holyrood, which increases other costs, for example, our catering costs. The way that we've had to handle the pandemic has also meant increased cleaning costs at Holyrood as well. So what we've had to do is a very active management of the budget to redirect and repurpose costs. And then that is what we're planning to do for the new financial year as well. And so we've not made any additional COVID-related costs associated with that. Then looking to the longer term, we have started to make some assumptions around what we're calling new ways of working, which is the way in which we expect that there's going to be some continuation of hybrid business for the Parliament, and that we need to invest and support that because it is more rather than less expensive to support that. We've introduced effectively two new services with hybrid business platform and the remote voting. And certainly Parliament is currently discussing that and will over the next few months, but there's certainly mood music that we will need to continue to support that. And in addition to that, we're obviously seeing more members, their staff, our staff, who may work more flexibly in the future, and that's going to drive up some of our costs around our IT and our technology in particular, in the, to be able to deliver that and make sure it's secure wherever people are located, and it's also performing well as well. So I think we're at the start of trying to make some assumptions around that, also how our estate will change. And some of that will drive benefits for our environmental and sustainability targets as well, obviously. But there's going to be, I think we're only at the start of understanding over the remainder of the session how some of that is going to get driven forward and will come up in subsequent budgets to the committee over the next few years.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so we've John to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks, convener. And I think I've got kind of two areas I wanted to touch on. Firstly, I note that the proposal is to give MSPs a 3.4% increase and staff cost provision to go up by 4.5%. Now, both of these seem quite generous, given that a lot of the other people in the public sector are only getting 1%. So I just wonder how you would answer a member of the public who said, you know, why are MSPs and their staff being treated so generously?
I think I would answer in the first instance by saying that we operate to indices that have been agreed by Parliament and to which we have adhered since we decoupled the members' salary costs from Westminster some years ago. At that point, we agreed to adhere to the ASH index. That would have produced last year an increase of 5.1% in the salaries of MSPs, and the corporate body, in the circumstances of the year, took the view that we would suspend that and cancel that increase. So I would point to that in the first instance. In relation to the staff cost provision, again, that relates to the indices that we have established. What actual salary costs are passed on to members of staff is, of course, a matter for each individual MSP. But what it does is it protects the integrity of the sum that it was agreed was necessary in order for MSPs to fulfil their function and to have the complement of staff at their disposal that they require to achieve that. So, I mean, I believe that it would be wrong to, you know, remove ourselves from those two indices without very careful consideration.
I mean, I accept that indices are important and it's good that it's not just totally subjective every year, but I mean, do you not think it would set out a good example if we just said, well, we're going to take 1% as well, just like a lot of the rest of the public sector?
I'm genuinely reluctant, Mr. Mason, to have the corporate body start interfering in that way. It was a very considerable decision on our part to take the decision not to take the increase last year. And I should say that was for MSPs. The office cost provision, staff cost provision, did actually increase. I'm not sure if the figure you're using is correct, but I know Michelle will be able to confirm that for me. But I've always been uncomfortable with the fact that the responsibility for establishing matters relating to our own pay rests with us. And that is why I think Parliament quite sensibly took the decision that we would align ourselves with a particular index. There was a discussion last year in the corporate body whether we should change that index. And I have to say, I was one of those who was reluctant to do so. Had we changed it, it would actually it would have recommended a larger increase for MSPs. So if you're requesting a hair shirt, Mr. Mason, by unintentioned consequence, I'm afraid you'll have to blame me for that lesser increase than you might otherwise have received.
Okay, fair enough. No, I just wanted to kind of raise that issue. And the other issue I wanted to raise was concerning the Scottish Commission for Human Rights. Now, they seem to be putting in a request, and you can maybe explain, or one of your colleagues can explain, where we are with that, because I see there's a figure of 300,000, which is in kind of contingency. And I mean, if I'm understanding the figures, that they're getting a 4.9% increase anyway, plus they're looking for this extra 25%. So that would be something like a 30% increase, which seems quite a lot.
Yes, you're quite right. I think there is a complicated underpinning to all of this, and David, I believe, is the best person to answer this in detail.
Thank you. Yeah, John Mason is correct with the figures that you mentioned there, and this is coming from a number of pressures that the Commission has communicated to the corporate body that is operating under. Principal amongst those is the consultation that the government is currently running on a human rights bill, and that would lead to increased responsibilities for the Commission. So they're looking ahead to the workload pressures that are going to come down through that. They've also referenced a number of other sources of pressures, including the Convention Rights Bill, the UNCRC Bill, which was the subject of a reference to the Supreme Court recently. So the Scottish Government is currently considering how to bring that back to the Parliament and what form to do that, but that will have increased responsibilities for the Commission as well. But what the corporate body has done here is requested a full business case from the Commission. It has received that business case, but rather than just accept that from the corporate body's level, excuse me, it's going to conduct an independent review. So that's why the corporate body is suggesting that the money that the Commission is looking for here is placed into contingency rather than put into the Commission's budget line at this stage, in order that that independent analysis can take place and the corporate body can have that independent assurance that the cost, the increased cost that the Commission is anticipating here, are fully justified and are played out in terms of the business case that is submitted.
Yeah, I mean, I take your point that you know, there are a number of exceptional circumstances. I suppose I just feel that there's other parts of the Scottish budget. I mean, obviously the NHS, which is facing also increased needs and just cannot get a 30% increase in their budget. And I suspect too, some of the other commissioners, like the Children's Commissioner, could easily spend an extra 30% in their budget. So I suppose I'd just be looking for an assurance that, you know, you will be very, between you, you'll be very strict and thorough and rigorous in just not handing out a 30% increase.
I can give you that absolute assurance, and that's why the corporate body has gone down the line of an independent review on the business case that's been put to it.
Okay, thanks, convener.
Michelle, to be followed by Douglas.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much, first of all, for the very fulsome information. Just going back a little bit, I wanted to just understand a wee bit more about the breakdown of where the convener was probing earlier in terms of additional resource implications. You've described how you see that the Brexit additional Brexit resource cost has gone down as we've moved out of transition. But I wanted to understand a little bit more about your forecasting for the additional costs, both in terms of headcount, FTE, and costs for the Internal Market Act, what's triggered by that, and more in particular, some of the funds that we've seen where spend is being spent directly in Scotland by the UK government. I think perhaps you allude to that in your sentence. I'll just quote where you talk about the UK government makes decisions which have a direct impact on devolved areas. So my question is, what specific additional headcount triggered by the UK Internal Market Act and any additional funds such as the Levelling Up Fund have you forecast in your budget for this year? And again, Jackson or David, I'm not sure who's best to answer that.
Well, I would go directly to David for that very specific response.
Thank you. I mean, I don't think that's an absolute figure that I can give to the member there, but what I can say is it's part of that parcel of pressures that are on the committee structure in the Parliament. So I referenced earlier the Internal Markets Act, common frameworks, all of the scrutiny that comes with that, that ability of the UK government to legislate in areas that were previously legislated for, either at the EU level or purely at a devolved level. But the analysis that's been done by that scrutiny group, which consists of the committee office, the spice office and the participation and communities team, has led to an increased bid there of 21 posts. The vast majority of the temporary posts that we currently have sit in that group, so it's actually a net increase of 11 posts there. I think 10 of the temporary posts are already in that group. So that gives you an idea of the scale. That's by far and away where we see the biggest pressures. The rest of the staff increase that we're looking for is spread across four other parts of the organisation. But I can say that the bulk of this is coming from the complications, the hugely complex nature of the post-EU environment.
Yeah, and I do appreciate that it's extremely complex. I absolutely understand that. And thank you for the figures there. And that's useful to have on the record, I feel. Given the uncertainty over that and what looks to be an increased provision going forward, would you see there coming a point where you would seek to charge back the cost incurred by the Scottish Parliament to the UK government? Because we are, in accounting terms, in uncharted territory, where this may come to be seen as something beyond and special our normal operating environment, if you like. Is charging back or having that discussion something that you've considered? Or if not, is it something you would consider?
It's not something that I have considered, and I'm not sure that that would fit with the budgetary process, when the corporate body's ability to top slice from the consolidated fund gives it the ability to identify the increased pressures on it and to top slice that money from the consolidated fund when that becomes part of the Scottish bloc. So charging back is not part of the process that we normally deal with here, and it's certainly not something that I've considered.
I know I probably asked a question nobody's thought about, but it may well come to that point if the headcount and the additional cost is deemed to be so significant. Jackson, I wanted to ask you just a wee question. You mentioned tax in the light of the additional security requirements for members. I wondered what assurances you could give that the tax treatment vis-a-vis benefit in kind between members of the Scottish Parliament and members of Westminster would be completely aligned. You may not have been alluding to that, so apologies if you weren't, but I just wanted to ask.
I think it's important that there is whatever equalities can be achieved, and we are actually taking advice from HMRC directly at the present time, and all of this is under very active consideration. You can be assured of that point.
Okay, thank you very much. That's me, convener.
Okay, thank you. Douglas, we're followed by Daniel.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, everyone. Jackson, you mentioned the debate that took place last week, and I actually watched that, and there was a feeling amongst most people that hybrid working of some sort is you know, here to stay. You'd also mentioned in that debate that the, you know, blue jeans had actually failed last week, and you know, it's the thoughts whether there should be an alternative backup system in case that happens again, and also thoughts about remote voting. Sometimes in the chamber that takes, I would say, quite a while, and it's frustrating for a number of people. So is there provision in the budget for looking at those two areas to look at ways to improve it or change the systems we use at present?
Well, I, from a very personal point perspective, it always occurs to me that a vote in the House of Commons takes about 15 minutes. And sometimes we've got about 10 or 11 of these divisions of the Scottish Parliament, and that does occur to me that if we were to follow that process, we'd still be there for several hours. I understand the frustrations that some members have experienced. Sometimes, of course, this is the robustness of the IT connection and network where the member is seeking to vote from. But I still think it's a remarkable job that we've managed to do in the time concerned. I might cheekily suggest that I've sometimes seen in the chat line, not so much in this parliament, but maybe in the last, some familiar faces who were struggling to actually complete the voting process. But I'll say no more than that. But we recognise, I think, that what might have been thought of as being merely a temporary requirement is now, for the foreseeable future, a requirement that we have to meet. And I think that, as was said in the debate last week, changes that might never have been contemplated at all in the longer term working of the Parliament now seem more palatable and beneficial, potentially, than might have been the case had we discussed them in an abstract way prior to the pandemic. And that, therefore, requires us to continue to invest in the technology that we have to ensure that that is robust. But again, I'll turn to David, but be assured we are aware of the difficulties they've had and are working all the time to improve that. But I don't think we will ever be in an environment which is absolutely 100% secure from any kind of failing. And I don't think there is any other parliament in that position either. But David.
Say that the two offerings that we currently have, so the virtual platform and remote voting, were platforms that we put together at high speed. Mm-hmm. If this was something that was a planned exercise, we would probably give ourselves at least 6 months, if not longer, to set these platforms up. So we just needed to get on and make the best of the situation that we found ourselves in. But we have made adjustments and changes as we go along. And I, like you, listened very carefully to the debate last Thursday, I think it was, to monitor how members were coping with it and what their views were. And one of the things that I noted there was frustration with the inability for members to intervene in each other if somebody's contributing from a virtual environment. And just as one example, that's an enhancement that we're actively looking at the moment. I've seen a pilot of how that might work. It looks very good to me, so we're currently going into a testing phase. So that's an example of an enhancement that we're seeking to make. We're also looking at a complete replacement of the sound and voting system in the chamber, and that will encompass the remote voting. We've had to pause on that because the market has just changed rapidly since the whole world went into lockdown situations. So we're waiting to see how the market matures in that front, but we're actively looking to build on the platforms that we already have. Our assumption is that post-pandemic, whenever that might be, we will be retaining some element of hybrid proceedings, and we think it's incumbent on us to make sure that those offerings are the best possible that they can be, and the ability to present parliamentary proceedings in the best possible light. So that's what's driving our support for these ongoing platforms.
And I would just like to point out, you know, I was in no way being critical, I realised that these systems were, you know, put together at pace. It's just looking ahead that we, you know, we do realise that we're probably going to have some sort of hybrid working for the future. Should we be looking at the systems? We've probably got a bit more time, I guess, because we have something else in place. And there was no way being critical of the staff that put these systems together at pace.
Okay, is that you, Douglas?
Yes, thanks, Convener.
Okay, Daniel.
Thank you very much, Convener. And I think my colleagues have covered over off the major issues. So this may seem slightly niche and left field, but the shopkeeper in me couldn't help but look over the figures for the Parliament shop. And I was just wondering if I could make some observations. At a revenue of £250,000 per year, and given that the pre-COVID, and given that visitor footfall in that year was around 260,000 visitors, that strikes me as being very low revenue. And I think it is important in these times that we ensure that the Parliament maximises not just its ability to control costs, but maximise revenue. I would also observe that in the forecasts that you've made is that the gross profit margin is going to jump from 44% to 50%. Now, I think 50% is a better profit margin for a gift shop, but any forecast that sees a gross profit margin increasing by 5% would make me ask how that is being achieved. I would also observe that it is really not accounting for the true costs of operating the shop. There are no utilities, there's no hypothecated rent, and that would, if you added those things on, I would suggest that the shop is probably running at a loss, given that it's only anticipated to make a £17,000 profit. And therefore, I would ask the question whether or not it is sensible for the Parliament to be directly managing the shop, and whether or not it might be better to essentially lease and perhaps license the shop, i.e. let it to a third party, but perhaps operating under license to use the Scottish Parliament branding and so on. I mean, especially thinking about the other public sector providers who run very successful shops, such as museums and galleries and so on. So there's a lot in there, but I think there's a broader theme about, are we making best use of the visitor shop so that we can maybe generate something more than 80 pence per visitor than we seem to be generating from the existing setup?
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. The shopkeeper in you, the radical shopkeeper in you, indeed, advocating the privatisation of our parliamentary estate.
I wouldn't call it that, Mr. Carlo, but you get the broad theme.
Very legitimate question. And both Sarah, who's been with us but not able to contribute, and Michelle, I think, might be able just to sort of come in on both separately in relation to this. So just on some of the numbers, I think, in the first instance, Sarah, and then Michelle, on how we are trying to engage with the use of the parliamentary estate in different ways, which I hope might address the latter part of your question.
Hi, can everyone hear me now? Okay.
Yeah.
Morning, everyone. So I'll respond to the question in terms of like the margins and the financials and whether it's fully costed or not. And I think, yeah, you know, we agree that we're not representing the shop as a fully costed entity. I guess that's never been a priority to do so. And we do use even the staff resourcing quite flexibly. So the team would also be supporting other engagement activities and the likes. So yes, you're absolutely right. I mean, I guess the nature of having a shop is that's a different angle, you know, like that. You know, that's a choice that's been made in terms of supporting engagement and the like, and it's probably one that Michelle can answer more fully in terms of, you know, historic reviews of the purpose of the shop, what it serves, and what actual genuine opportunities we have, given it's within the grounds, access is limited, and the like. So, Michelle, I don't know if you want to come in on that. Thanks.
Okay, yes, I will come in on that. It's obviously, I think, being part of that wider experience for the public who come to Holyrood to engage for a range of reasons in terms of why the shop was there in the first place. And it's been looked at over many years. And I think the idea has also been looked at in terms of, should it be something that was run by an external provider? And one of the challenges that we have with the shop is, of course, that you have to come into a secure environment, you have to come through security to come in. So that naturally constrains the footfall to those who are either pass holders in the building or those who are seeking to engage with the Parliament. And I think that has been a barrier to looking at whether we outsource the shop as a sort of going concern. There has been a gradual drop in visitor footfall over the last sort of decade for the Parliament, and the new group head has been looking at a public engagement strategy to try and stimulate how we continue to engage with the public. And obviously there's a lot of new drivers for that, because we expect, obviously, post-pandemic to see new and different ways in which the public might seek to engage with the Parliament, which might not all be about physically being on site at the Parliament. So I think that there is a need to go back and kind of look at our whole offering in the main hall, and I know that that's something that's been given active consideration at the moment, and I'm sure that the shop will be part of the mix in there in looking at the range of what we provide to visitors and how we can assure ourselves that we are seeking to maximise income and keep these things as a going concern as part of that overall offering at Holyrood.
Well, can I just make one additional suggestion? I mean, I think, you know, given that this is 2021 and that no items are being sold online, can I just gently suggest that that is an opportunity that shouldn't be overlooked? And likewise, you know, if you were to find an MSP that had particular expertise in retail, you might want to ask them whether they could provide any observations.
I will personally take that suggestion back to the corporate body, Mr. Johnson, as a former customer of your former shopkeeping empire. I will certainly be very happy to encourage that suggestion that we do exactly that.
As long as it's on a non-commission basis.
Absolutely. It's just out of you know, a sense of public duty.
Of course. Okay, well, I think that concludes our questions from the committee absolutely on time. So I want to thank Jackson Cameron and supporting officials for their evidence today. And I now suspend the meeting for 5 minutes to allow final checks to take place before the Cabinet Secretary's session. So thank you very much, everyone.
to you again.
We are now joined for our second evidence session on the Scottish Budget 22-23 by Kate Forbes, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy. Ms Forbes is joined by Scottish Government officials, Lucille Carroll, Director of Tax and Fiscal Sustainability, Douglas McLaren, Deputy Director of Budget, Pay and Pensions, and Ian Storey, Head of Local Government Finance. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary to the meeting, and I again remind members and witnesses that our broadcasting team will operate the microphones and that they should pause for a few seconds before speaking to ensure they will be heard. I intend to bring members in to speak in the order we discussed earlier, but if anyone would like to come in at another point, please type R into the chat function. All questions were directed to the Cabinet Secretary in the first instance. If Ms Forbes wants to an official to respond on a particular point, please make this clear so our broadcasting team can bring them in. We are up to 2 hours for this session. Before I open up the session, I'd like to wish good morning to Ms Forbes and ask her to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks to the committee for allowing me to come and give evidence so quickly after the publication of the budget. And obviously, events over the last 2 weeks have almost overtaken the budget that was published, so this scrutiny session is hugely important. This is another challenging budget, probably the most fiscally challenging that I have ever been involved with over the last few years. It should now, I hope, be beyond debate that our overall funding for next year from the UK government is falling. But on the other hand, I recognise that our funding is greater than its pre-COVID levels. And hopefully we can get into some of these numbers and data in the course of our scrutiny session. I am keen to provide as much transparency as possible around the budget, given the extreme levels of volatility and uncertainty that we are seeing right now, particularly in our fiscal outlook. And I've set out clearly where we've had to make assumptions around our funding and also some of the difficult choices. Because even before Omicron hit, it was clear that public services' response to COVID would continue beyond the end of this financial year. But over and above the impact of COVID, it's important as part of our recovery that we push ourselves to be as ambitious as possible within our fiscal constraints. It's very much a budget of choices, and it's actually a transitional budget too, continuing to address immediate pressures in the NHS and supporting the recovery effort. And it should be seen as a stepping stone on the road to our resource spending review for the longer term. The choices that we have made are all informed by the priority themes of tackling inequality, supporting economic recovery and fulfilling our net zero obligations. And Convener, just as I close, I appreciate that the committee will have been busy this morning, but I know the committee has in the past been interested in not just where budgets are spent, but how budgets operate. And I would commend the report that I've just seen this morning from David Bell, David Iser and David Phillips on budgets, which underlines the need for fiscal flexibilities and guarantees at a time of volatility like just now, which hopefully is in line with much of the committee's discussions in the past. And on that, Convener, I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And indeed, I'm sure the committee will look forward to looking at the report from the three Davids. Now, as you'll be aware, Cabinet Secretary, there have been conflicting advice and information given to the committee with regard to the size of the Scottish budget from Scottish Fiscal Commission, SPICE, Scottish Government itself, Fraser Allender. But if we take the Scottish Fiscal Commission as being the one that we are looking at today and the implications of that, it says that the Scottish Government budget next year will be 2.6% lower than in 21-22 after accounting for inflation, the reduction is 5.2%. But at the same time, spending on the Scottish Government's largest social security payments, including new payments, is forecast to be £764 million more
than forecast by the funding available through the UK's block grant adjustment in 24-25, which reduces the funding available for other spending priorities. So, given that the latest SFC forecast shows Scotland lagging behind the UK in economic performance and income tax receipts falling behind the block grant adjustment, and social security spending exceeding the block grant adjustment, how do we ensure fiscal sustainability?
Thanks, convener. I'll answer that question, if I might, in different parts. Firstly, just on the size of the budget, you're right that the Scottish Fiscal Commission is the one to prioritise, because ultimately I can't spend a penny more than the SFC has forecast. So in terms of the overall size of the budget, that really matters. The Treasury figures are useful too, because as set out in their own block grant transparency publication, that indicates that the block grant is less than the current aggregate for 21-22. In every year of the spending review. So for resource, that's a £2.6 billion in real term reduction for next year, and capital is a £0.5 billion real terms reduction in 22-23. But specifically on the forecast deficits, which you reference, I think one of the keys is to use the forthcoming resource spending review to plan the future years. So when it comes to social security in particular, but also income tax as well, we know that the Scottish Government needs to manage that within its budget. So the choices that we make have a direct impact on the level of funding that is available. I think there's an argument to be made, which I have made in the past and will continue to do so, around income tax and the methodologies that are used for block grant adjustments. But you will know about the forthcoming review of the fiscal framework, and I hope that that will feature. But when it comes to social security, that level of uncertainty, that level of a demand-led budget, bluntly, needs to be managed within a fixed budget. And I think that's where the multi-year spending plans are absolutely essential. They'll be the first time we've been able to do that for a number of years, and they will inevitably require us to make some very difficult decisions. But at the end of the day, they will allow us to plot out and plan how to best allocate available funding to meet our evolving priorities over the course of subsequent years.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. You said that the resource spending review would evolve to meet coming needs, but surely, you know, finding £764 million, which I understand, having questioned the SFC on it last week, is likely to be a conservative estimate, notwithstanding the fact that some people will be lifted out of poverty and hopefully won't require such benefits. Surely the number one priority should be, if we're not to end up reducing expenditure in other areas of the Scottish budget, to actually grow the Scottish economy faster than the UK economy, because the whole purpose really of having devolved taxation was to allow Scotland to benefit from the powers, albeit limited, to grow the economy greater than the UK economy, allowing for additional funding to be available to Scotland rather than trying to use a quarter into a tight pot by having trying to find £264 million from effectively.
Absolutely. So that is entirely my objective, is to grow the Scottish economy, ideally at a faster rate, but to ensure that people are in work, they're in well-paid jobs, in secure employment, that we are more productive as a country. And that's where the budget, I think, needs to be seen alongside some of the other work that we're doing from an economic perspective. So it's not just money that drives economic improvements. It's actually a wider policy landscape that enables businesses to take risks, that enables entrepreneurs to flourish and to prosper. But I think you can't get away either from what some of the drivers are, for example, on income tax performance. So we know that the Scottish economy is disproportionately exposed to the oil and gas sector as one example. Now, that's not me passing judgment, it's just a fact. So in terms of the volatility in oil and gas, irrespective of what any politician around the committee table thinks, irrespective of what people think about the future of oil and gas, having been exposed to the oil and gas sector, we know that that means that higher redundancies leads to a knock-on impact on income tax. So, you know, I think we need to understand what some of the key drivers are for the exposure, the economic exposure, which in turn it leads to income tax performance. I think there's two ways of resolving that. One is through the fiscal framework, because I'm certainly pressing to ensure that the fiscal framework mirrors more of what the Welsh fiscal framework does in terms of taking into account the nature of the Scottish tax base. But the second thing is to ensure that all sectors in Scotland are prospering. We have recently heard of Lloyds Banking Group, PwC, saying that Scotland is already and will continue to be the place in the UK for green jobs. Now, create those jobs, ensure that, you know, we attract talent to Scotland. That talent then obviously contributes to public coffers, and overall you see a net benefit to the Scottish budget. So just to reinforce that, I absolutely agree, you cannot look at the budget independently of our economic aspirations for Scotland.
Okay, well, following on from that, you said on the 9th of December, and I quote that in your statement, although the budget lays the groundwork for a green economic recovery from COVID-19, we must be clear the UK government spending review has hindered rather than helped us on that mission. So I wonder if you can highlight that a little bit. But also, Spice, in page 11 of their report to the committee, said that in terms of four of the 11 portfolios, four of the 11 portfolios fall in both cash and real terms. And though of those four, one is net zero energy and transport. So surely, you know, that if the priority is to try and boost the economy, you know, and indeed take on the challenge of the climate emergency, why among four portfolios where funding is falling in real terms in this budget, according to Spice, is net zero energy and transport? And indeed, finance and economy, so two portfolios, sorry, net zero engine transport being one, finance and economy being the other. Why are these two portfolios having reductions in their funding?
So, in terms of your first answer, the spending review, I think I've probably answered that in terms of the fact that our budget is falling in every year of the spending review period. So this, as it were, is a challenging outlook for Scotland. And that, you know, underlines the challenging choices that we have had to make. The second element to that is, of course, in terms of investment opportunities. Let's take investment in infrastructure or investment in the transition to net zero. From a capital perspective, obviously, the UK government can do that through borrowing. So, but ultimately, I'm constrained by what's allocated to us in the spending review. In terms of the overall budgets, I mean, I can go through the detail of the net zero and the finance and economy budget. This has not been an easy budget. So I guess the bottom line for me is that on one hand, you have headlines saying record funding for Scotland, but on the other hand, the hard choices that we have to make is to determine where that funding is spent. And certainly within the net zero energy and transport portfolio, we have absolutely prioritised that investment in net zero and that transition to net zero. And you can see that in the budget itself, where there is significant investment in some of the climate change initiatives, huge investment in energy, you know, ramping up the delivery of the Heat in Buildings programme, doubling Home Energy Scotland's budget in terms of energy efficiency, investing in hydrogen and carbon capture and storage via the Emerging Energy Technologies Fund. So there's significant investment. I go back to where I started, that this is a budget of choices, and we have chosen as one of our key three key themes to invest in that transition to net zero, and you see that in the infrastructure portfolio. On the finance and economy one, the choices I've made there are to prioritise our enterprise agencies. So to prioritise Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and the South of Scotland Enterprise, as well as the Scottish National Investment Bank, as key levers and agents of economic growth. Now, there will be views and opinions on how they can do their job better, and I'm engaging with them. But ultimately, from a budget perspective, that is what I have prioritised.
Okay, again, going back to your statement on the 9th of December, you said again, and I quote, an income tax that government's priorities need to make the tax system fairer and more progressive and to protect low and middle taxpayers. But again, if we look at page 18 of the House report, it says, and I quote, Scottish taxpayers who earn between the proposed Scottish higher tax threshold of £43,662, which is not increased by inflation, that's indeed the UK one hasn't, and the RUK higher rate threshold, £50,270, will pay 41% income tax and 12% national contribution on their earnings between these two amounts, combined tax rate of 53%. That means, in actual fact, people in Scotland earning between £43,500 and £52,500 will actually be paying more in tax than people who earn more than that. So someone on £51,000 will have a marginal rate of taxation of 43% because of the 10% reduction in national insurance. So how can that be deemed to be progressive, given that that includes a lot of people who have families and large mortgages?
The issue with higher rate taxpayers paying the marginal tax rate of 53% on income between the Scottish and the UK higher rate thresholds is, to my mind, another sign of the inadequacy of the devolution settlement. So, you know, that issue is exacerbated by the decision to introduce the health and social care levy next year. And that means that those taxpayers are facing a combined marginal rate of 54.25%. Now, I recently wrote to the Chief Secretary to the Treasury to request that the national insurance upper earnings limit for Scottish taxpayers should be aligned with the Scottish higher rate threshold. But, you know, that's not been granted. So my sense of it is that if we believe in full devolution of income tax, or even if we believe in full devolution of non-savings, non-dividends income tax, which is what's happened, then we also need to have a voice about the other areas of tax policy that interact with that. You've talked to me just there about the interaction with national insurance contributions. There's also interactions with pensions. There's also interactions with some of the allowances that are available. It's just that often the national insurance contribution issue dominates. But, you know, I think taking a step back, we have chosen, and I think it's quite clear, that to make income tax fairer and more progressive. So the majority, 54% of taxpayers, will pay less income tax next year than they would if they lived elsewhere in the UK. But, you know, that's balanced by the fact that we're asking those who can afford it to contribute a little bit more. And I think that in return, those living in Scotland continue to have access to a wider and better funded range of access to public services in the UK, whether that's prescriptions or tuition fees.
Yeah, I mean, I can understand your argument there with regard to the UK, and obviously that's something I subscribe to, but surely if people earning over £43,662, you know, are going to be confronted by a 54.25% marginal rate of tax, then perhaps the threshold should have been increased rather than allowing fiscal brag to ensnare more people in that tax net.
Well, I mean, we have frozen, obviously, the higher and top rate thresholds. We've increased the starter and basic rate bands. We have echoed largely what the UK government has done in terms of freezing bans as well. I recognise that decisions made in prior years mean that that gap has basically now remained frozen this year.
Okay, well, one of the areas of which is a real bone of contention, as it is every year, is local government. And again, when we look at the four portfolios which have had a reduction in cash real terms, one of them is social justice, housing and local government, according to page 11 of the SPICE report. However, last night I received a copy of the local government finance 22-23 total revenue support, and it does look overall to be quite reassuring. Across Scotland, the budget, according to this, increases from 11,043 million to 11,853 million, which is an £810 million, 7.3% increase. So that looks good. £390 million of that is undistributed. So I wonder if you can maybe give us some information about when it will be distributed, how it will be distributed. But when I looked at the actual local authorities and their actual increase with regard to this funding, I was disappointed to note that the wealthier, more prosperous areas such as Aberdeenshire, in East Renfrewshire and Edinburgh have significant increases of 4.3%, 4.8% and 4.9%. But if we look at the poorer areas of Scotland, for example, what we see is, you know, the Western Isles getting a 2.1% increase, West Bartonshire 2.9%, 3.3% for Inverclyde and Glasgow, Dundee 3.1%, and North Ayrshire, which I represent, 3.5%. So, I mean, I'm aware of the local government funding formula, but surely it's, we can't have a situation in a challenging funding situation where areas of highest poverty and highest unemployment and indeed the ageing populations, because many of the younger people are moving out with Scotland or indeed to the more prosperous areas of Scotland, such as Edinburgh, East End and Aberdeenshire, are getting lower local government settlements.
Thanks, Convener. There's several questions in there that I'll try and take in turn. The first is on the undistributed sums that you reference. So undistributed sums like that are all considered by the settlement and distribution group, and their next meeting is on January the 18th, I believe. So that's how undistributed sums will then be distributed. In terms of the overall settlement, and I know there's been a lot of conflicting views about the settlement itself, can I again say that I am not here to deny challenging decisions that have had to be made in this budget, because I've had to make them. There are challenging decisions in the budget. And what I would distinguish within the local government budget, because they distinguish between their core budget and the overall settlement, is that we have protected the core budget in cash terms, and there has also been a real terms growth to the overall settlement. Now, in terms of the wider settlement, these are not just Scottish Government priorities. These are, by and large, shared priorities. Most local authorities will tell you, for example, that there are acute challenges within social care, acute challenges when it comes to recruit and the funding position, which is where that additional £200 million to support investment in health and social care is so important as part of the overall consequentials that have come. On your last question, though, I think that is a very, very pertinent question, which is ultimately a question about methodology. And I will once again repeat what I've said in previous years, which is that I am completely open to considering any changes to the funding methodology. You will appreciate that that needs to come from COSLA as much as it comes from me. And there needs to be agreement in COSLA about reviewing that funding methodology. I think that we should review the methodology, but I cannot do that without a request from COSLA to do so.
Okay, now on this meeting, the 18th of January, is there an opportunity with this £19.4 million of unallocated resources to reallocate some of that to some of these poorer local authorities?
Well, Convener, if I could bring in Ian Storey, if that's possible, to speak to what the Settlement and Distribution Group does. It's a fairly standardised process. So, Ian.
Thanks, Ms. Forbes. And sorry, Convener. So the settlement distribution group is a joint group between COSLA and local government officials, and it decisions on the distribution of funding on the basis of the most appropriate metrics for the particular sums. So if the sums are based on poverty alleviation or something, then that would typically benefit the poorer local authorities. But if it's based on, for example, teacher numbers, might be based on the number of pupils, the numbers of schools and things like that. So the distribution methodology is applied separately to each of these individual lines on the basis of the formula and the methodology that COSLA and Scottish Government both think is most appropriate for that funding line. And the settlement and distribution group consists of Scottish Government, local authorities and directors of finance. And then all decisions of the settlement and distribution group are then endorsed by COSLA leaders. So it goes back to Ms. Forbes' point that ultimately all of these decisions are taken jointly with COSLA on distribution.
Okay, thank you for that clarification. I could ask more questions, but I want to move on, so I'm going to let colleagues in a couple of minutes. Just a couple more really for me. Well, first is, in developing its budget, the Scottish Government assumed it would receive extra income of £620 million. The resource budget in 2022-23 from a number of sources, some of which are still a matter of negotiation between the Scottish and UK governments. Now, committee pressed the Scottish Fiscal Commission and economists last week for details of that, and they weren't really able to solve the mystery of what these sources are and how much they will be, and more importantly, the likelihood of them coming to Scotland. So I'm just wondering, Cabinet Secretary, if you can enlighten us a wee bit.
Yes, happily, and I could perhaps remind the committee of our position last year. So the budget last year included £500 million of additional Barnett consequentials, which had not been confirmed, but an assessment was made that it was highly likely for that funding to come, and those assumptions were ultimately exceeded in aggregate. So we do try and take decisions in the budget based on the best available evidence because of the way that the funding position works. You will all know that in year we often have additional announcements that are being made, which if they had been baked into the budget from the beginning might have led to more efficient use of funding. So in this year, next year's budget, we've made similar assumptions surrounding likely sources of income, and those include firstly, income from the next round of offshore wind leasing. So the precise scale and profile of that income is expected to be confirmed early in the new year. And if the budget perhaps had been later, as it has been in the last 2 years, then that would have been factored in. The second is a resolution of a long-standing disagreement with Treasury on the effect of personal allowance adjustments to the block grant. The methodology was finally confirmed this summer, but it is still part of a live discussion and negotiation. And then the last one is further Barnett consequentials, including some which, despite being linked to UK spending announcements, weren't included in the 21-22 funding position. In other words, announcements that were made, but the funding actually hasn't yet been drawn down in this year. Now, again, from my perspective, if the budget was later, let's say we were passing it in March, it's quite likely that we would have been in a position to factor all of these things in. So, you know, we have considered all of these sources individually and collectively to arrive at a prudent risk assessed figure of £620 million of additional expected resource funding. And, you know, it's important to lastly say that we have not made any assumption on the availability of resource funding from the Scotland Reserve, but we will see how this year pans out. Obviously, the additional Omicron challenges are putting extreme pressure on this year's budget, so it's quite unlikely that there will be much to carry forward into next year.
Okay, now there has been a lot of debate and discussion on the resources available to the Scottish Government, but there doesn't seem to be much on capital and infrastructure. I think everyone accepts the figure in the budget, page 2, there's a 9.7% reduction in real terms with regard to capital. And indeed, that is also backed by the SPICE report we received actually on page 34. Now,
obviously this is, has significant implications for Scotland and the capital programme, especially as the cost of materials is going much higher than the general rate of inflation. So what are the implications? What projects in Scotland do you feel are likely to be put on hold? From repairing fewer potholes to building more schools, what will be the implications for Scotland on that quite severe cut in capital resource from the United Kingdom?
Yeah, so we had obviously set out, again, in the interests of being clear and transparent, we had set out our capital spending review at last autumn, which set out where we intended to invest over the coming years. And unfortunately, the capital that was allocated to us through the comprehensive spending review from the UK government was lower than the conservative and cautious estimates that we had provided in the capital spending review. So it may be that some of that capital commitment will need to be managed over a longer time period, but I would still refer the committee to the commitments that we made in that capital spending review, because that has informed the choices that we have made in this year's budget. And we've also, of course, chosen to make use of capital borrowing as well. So in terms of some of the high level lines on capital, significant investment in infrastructure, significant investment in decarbonisation efforts, significant investment through the Capital Regeneration Grant Fund. So there's quite a clear and ambitious willingness in the budget to use as much capital as possible, particularly next year when economic recovery is still vitally important. I mean, I'm happy to unpack any particular line, but hopefully that gives a general overview to our capital position.
Yes, that's very helpful, in fact. And just lastly from me, you talk about choices, and indeed you have made your choices and we can agree or disagree with those choices. But in discussion with representatives of the opposition parties, have they provided any choices to you? In other words, rather than just simply ask for additional expenditure on a number of areas, have they pointed out where in the Scottish budget reductions can be made, or indeed where taxes can be raised in order to fund what their demands are?
It is the hardest part of any budget to identify what must be reduced in order to increase other lines. I've met with all the opposition spokespeople once. I'm keen to meet with them again now that they've seen the budget. There may be more clarity on changes to approach. But I have only heard from the opposition, and I may hear differently over the course of today, where budgets should increase, and I'm very sympathetic to that. I would love a budget where every decision is easy because we're able to invest at the requisite level in all areas of the public sector. Unfortunately, the nature of budgets does not allow that. Budgets must be informed by choices, and there's some difficult choices in this budget that I'm not hiding from. And there's obviously areas of criticism that I've heard loud and clear over the last 2 weeks. But I come back to this position, which is I have maximised the funding available to us. You've heard already what I've said about the £620 million of assumed additional funding. So there is no funding that I'm withholding or sitting on, not least because I don't need to negotiate a deal this year. And therefore, with every penny on the face of the budget, it is a question, if we are to, for example, increase local government settlement, then where should it come from? And if we are to ultimately agree that health consequentials should go to health, which is obviously something that the UK government is pushing strongly and something that the Scottish government has incorporated, then it does leave room for manoeuvre. It does leave very little room for manoeuvre for other budgets.
Okay, well, thank you very much for so patiently answering my questions. We'll now open up the session, and the first colleague to ask a question will be Liz, to be followed by John.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary. I know that you're very keen, Cabinet Secretary, that we stick to the facts that are contained within the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and that's informed your budget, and I will try very hard to do that. Just before I come to questions about some of the Scottish Fiscal Commission's comments, can I just go to the Scottish Government consolidated accounts for 2020-21, page 104, where it shows that there was an underspend of the 580 million that's broken down across portfolios, some that have an overspend, that some have a very considerable underspend, big portfolios like health and sport and transport infrastructure. Can I just be quite clear, Cabinet Secretary, about why that underspend exists and what informed the choices when it comes to overspend and underspend?
Thanks, and also thanks, Liz Smith, for the way that you've asked that question, because I think it allows us to perhaps bring a bit more light than heat to the issues. And I'm very happy to go through the figures one by one to explain. And just for the record, I have no issue with Audit Scotland's very important report. You know, I think Audit Scotland play a hugely important role. In terms of the figures, and you talked, I think, in terms of the page, £580 million is the figure that has been identified on the total Scottish budget. So that's not just COVID consequentials, that's a total Scottish budget. Incidentally, that is against an overall budget of about £50.7 billion. So it's 1.1% of the total. If we divide that further, £207 million of that is underspend on capital projects. Now, that's primarily because of the impact of the last quarter, which you will recall we were in lockdown. A lot of initiatives weren't able to proceed and draw down that capital. And so there was an appeal from whether it was community groups or local government or otherwise to try and manage the slippage into this year. So all of that funding has been allocated on an ongoing basis to capital needs, including in infrastructure. And that's why you see, as one of the key lines where there was an underspend, £321 million, it's in transport infrastructure and connectivity. So just to draw that line. In terms of the resource, again, I would draw your attention to the fact that it's the health line which is seeing a significant underspend. Now, you may wonder why on earth, in a pandemic, that is the case for health. The key, you will again recall that in the last month of 2020 and in the first few months of 2021, there's quite considerable late consequentials, particularly for things like vaccination programmes. Now, I recall the conversations I had with health at the time, that if I had obliged them to spend all of that in the run-up to the end of the financial year, it wouldn't have made for a smooth spending pattern into this financial year. So we agreed with health that we would try and manage some of their budget through the reserve, specifically for health, so that the challenges immediately after the beginning of the new financial year and immediately prior to the end of the financial year, in other words, we wouldn't see strange behaviour as they desperately try to draw down before the end of the financial year and instead could manage the COVID response over that 31st of March bridge. I realise I'm going on. I want to answer your question. Where it's gone, though. So the autumn budget revision was obviously, the autumn budget revision was passed, I think, just a few months ago, and it has formally allocated £560 million of that original £580 million. So in terms of where it's been allocated, all the lines are in that autumn budget revision, and it gives a full account for how it has been spent. And again, what you will see is that the bulk of it, well, a lot of it has gone on health, so it's health drawing down on that funding.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that answer. I asked the question because obviously there are people around the country where if they see that there is an underspend on the Scottish budget at a time, as you said yourself, that there's a pandemic and there's very serious issues within business. And I think it was you yourself last week who said that you'd spent absolutely every penny that you had to hand in your budget, and another 100 million appears for business. Do you understand the public concern about that 580 million being there, but not necessarily being spent at a time where people have got really urgent concerns?
Absolutely. And if I could make two further points, I would strongly advise people to look at the page that you have referenced, and they will see in the economy line the fact that of all the budget lines, the economy line overspent. In other words, for business support, we considerably spent more than the funding that had been given. Such was the importance I placed on helping businesses through. So I'd make that point. The second point I would make is to compare this with previous years. So it's well documented every year that there's much complaining about the Scottish Government carrying an underspend, which I agree. We can't overspend. It's illegal for me to overspend. And therefore, as we get closer to the end of the financial year, it is a bit like landing a 747 on a postage stamp of coming in under budget. And if you compare previous years, the comparison for the previous year was a £669 million underspend. That's 1.7%. So the fact that it was 580, 1.1%, £392 million was allocated in the budget bill, £168 million in the autumn budget revision. I appreciate budgets are hugely complex and there's lots of different material. What I can say is that every penny is accounted for and every penny has been spent. And I maximise the value of every single penny in a COVID year because I know the needs far outstrip the availability of funding.
And Cabinet Secretary, you're quite right. You can't overspend. That's absolutely a legal requirement for the government. But notwithstanding what you said in answer to my first question, there are choices to be made. And what I'm trying to drill down on is when it comes to certain underspends, which were large in the health budget, you've explained some of that about future requirements when it comes to vaccines, etc. I absolutely understand that. But there are issues within infrastructure and transport, etc. And people are asking, quite rightly, in a period of really urgent economic assistance that's required, exactly what has driven the choices about when you hold some money back for the next set of financial payments, and what drives these choices that you have to make, and that's really what I'm trying to ask you: is what do you absolutely prioritise when it comes to that underspend money?
Well, on the infrastructure side, it's capital. So capital can't be spent for business grants. It can't be spent on day-to-day services. Capital is allocated, for example, to the building of a new school. Someone comes to me, let's say the hospital costs £100 million. That hospital will cost £100 million. They will draw down that £100 million. They may not complete the hospital by the end of the financial year. And I can't turn around and say to them, tough luck, you ain't getting the rest of your hospital because it needs to be spent by the end of the financial year. What I say to them is, OK, you've got £20 million worth to build. We'll carry that forward for you. So when you say, ask me about choices, I do not hold money back. The only time I have held money back, and it was well documented, was last December or just before December, where we were given significant additional funding of over £1 billion in the last 4 months of the financial year. And if you recall, I allocated it all and said that I would hold £300 million in case of a wave. And what happened on the 5th of January? We were all locked down, and thankfully there was £300 million to invest in business. But I do not hold money back. All of the funding is allocated. The question is whether it can be drawn down by, for example, vaccination teams, by the new hospital that's being built. And so those are the choices. The choices are determined particularly during COVID, by a very, very volatile situation. And I would much rather we budgeted intelligently rather than suddenly try to get rid of money at the end of the financial year. My last brief comment is, you will remember, I remember the 24th of December last year, we had been pressing the UK government, the 22nd and the 23rd, whether there would be additional consequentials. We were told there would be no further consequentials. I think it was late on the 23rd or the 24th, suddenly there was hundreds of millions of pounds of additional funding. So that then had to be spent intelligently on business support in very, very short order. But managing significant additional sums of money late on in the financial year leads to poor decision making if you cannot carry it forward beyond the 31st of March.
Well, I'm sure there'll be other consequentials that are just coming, where, you know, obviously there is an immediate request from various groups in the economy for that money, and I'm sure that will be well spent. Cabinet Secretary, can I just turn attention to two other sets of what I think are very important statistics, one from the Scottish Fiscal Commission, where it has said that, you know, tax revenue take is there's a shortfall of 190 million for 2022-23 projected, and that's possibly rising to 417 million by 26-27. At the same time, as we saw yesterday, the report that came out from the CBI and the KPMG with the productivity index, and put these together, the tax take, which in Scotland is not as strong as we would like, and refers back to some of the comments that you answered in terms of the convener's questions, that, you know, the economic growth in Scotland is not nearly good enough, let's be quite frank about that. And the productivity indices that were produced yesterday show some really worrying signs. And I want you to give us some idea of what you think has to happen to address some of the really serious issues within the structure of the Scottish economy, which is lagging behind not just other parts of the UK, but actually most other regions as well.
Yeah, thanks. You started by talking about income tax, and if I could just refer to that quickly, because obviously when it comes to income tax, the choices that we have made have created additional spending power for the Scottish budget. So, you know, I think there's a misunderstanding often about that. Where the challenge falls is in the relationship with the block grant adjustments and the fiscal framework. And a lot of this is to do with unequal growth between the highest and the lower earners. That's accounted for in the Welsh fiscal framework, not in Scotland. And I think that needs to be part of the review of the fiscal framework review. But moving on to productivity, because I think the report it was very useful in terms of breaking down the data, particularly where the challenge is. And I think it's an issue that developed economies all need to grapple with. You know, all developed economies have suffered from an extended period of weak productivity growth over the past decade or so. And tackling the challenge is not made any easier by the fact that we're facing into huge productivity headwinds as a result of, you know, labour shortages, as a result of supply chain disruption, as a result of our disruption to our trading relationship with our nearest and largest trading partners, and our demographic challenges too. So what are we doing about it? A number of points. One is that I agree with you that it's a top priority. So I'm not shying away from the fact that we need to grapple with our productivity challenge. And one of the primary ways that we are going to do that is going to be set out in our National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which is obviously our 10-year outlook. And there will be core data and key interventions recommended on the productivity, which have been informed by the Advisory Council of about 17 people. I am keen to publish that. You will appreciate that there are some tensions in publishing an economic strategy looking 10 years hence, when businesses right now, a few days before Christmas, are in severe difficulties. So there is a bit of a timing challenge in doing that, but a lot of that will look at the need for public investment in core infrastructure, private investment, how do we incentivise business to invest in their businesses, and lastly, on skills. How do we ensure the workforce are actually in the right jobs for the right businesses doing the right things. So that would be my three quick recommendations that I think we need to step up our activity on.
Thank you very much. My last question, convener, if that's all right. I mean, the GBI KPMG report is pretty blunt in certain areas. I mean, the good news is it's flagging up that we have huge educational potential, that the skills agenda is something that they're potentially looking at in terms of green jobs, etc. All that is good news. But when it comes to the traffic lights that they set out in terms of red, amber and green about how we compare to other parts of the UK, what our short-term basis is and what our long-term basis is, and there's some really worrying statistics in there about our weakness in business investment, in exports and in in-work training. And I would suggest, Cabinet Secretary, that these are really serious issues about the structure within the Scottish economy. So if you could just say a little bit more about how you intend to deal with these concerns.
Yeah, absolutely. So I think the report highlights that business investment as a share of GDP has increased over the past decade, but it's still low by OECD standards. And since 2018, it's fallen over the two consecutive years. What are we doing already? Global Capital Investment Plan, published earlier this year, is what it says on the tin, trying to attract additional capital investment, and also the Inward Investment Plan, published in 2020. Those are both key to improving Scotland's business investment performance. We've seen good data tracking against that, but these are not things that you can deliver within a matter of months. So I think we have already set ourselves the target in terms of business investment. But I think the second part you talked about was innovation, if I heard correctly, and the fact that the share of innovation active businesses in Scotland was about 32.2%, and it's decreased from about 50% in 2015. That area is one of the key elements to the national strategy and looking at how we develop actions to improve Scotland's performance. There are five objectives within the strategy. One is on productivity, one is on entrepreneurship, and both of them are very closely aligned in terms of innovation. I think it's about us incentivizing businesses to do what they want to do rather than us necessarily making substantial investment. And there's a few sectors in particular that are doing exciting things, from manufacturing through to the green economy, which I think are leading the way when it comes to innovation.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. In actual fact, towards the end of this session, I was going to ask you a whole range of questions on the KPMG and Fraser Alexander productivity dashboard. So Liz has saved the committee from those questions. Okay, so it's now joined to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you very much, convener. And yeah, we've covered quite a lot of ground already, but the convener mentioned this figure of £620 million. And I mean, that was obviously in the budget. And since then, we've had these two announcements from Westminster of allegedly £220 million twice that's going to help us. And in addition, I think the Scottish Government has found £200 million, as I understand it, for business support and for self-isolation. So I was just wondering, can you unpack for us how all these figures relate to each other? Is there any overlap? Are some contained in others, or are they all completely separate?
So on the 620, obviously it's for future years, but it was based on assumptions of funding that had been announced but not allocated. And that's all baked into next year. The £220 million, the first £220 million, was not a direct overlap. But there are announcements that had been made that we'd already baked into our budget. We hadn't assumed that we would get funding. So, for example, the £145 million relating to material change in circumstance, which the UK government has previously announced for businesses, and that was included in the £220 million, and it's also included in the £620 million. So that, I think, illustrates the point that there is some considerable overlap between money that had been announced by the UK government as new, but which is already very much factored into our budgets. What the UK government is saying is that it will come this year, and we'd assumed it would come next year. So it's not new money either way you look at it. The additional £220 million that was announced on Sunday night does appear to contain new funding. I would obviously again remind everybody that we only get funding consequentials from UK government spend. So this money is based on funding that the UK government obviously intend to spend between now and the end of the financial year, but they hadn't told us they intend to spend. That means that if there's any future announcements in the next few months about new UK government spend that generates consequentials, we've basically had an advance on future announcements between now and the end of the financial year. That's very complicated. I don't know if you want me to expand further, but hopefully that answers your question.
Yeah, well, just to kind of clarify, perhaps from my mind and maybe for a few others. So definitely that you're saying the 145 million was included in the 620 and is included in the 220. So we obviously can't use it twice. So the difference is what, 75 million. Okay, I think I get that.
In terms of the balance of that initial 220 was based on health funding that was expected already, so that the balance of the 220 was health funding. We actually anticipated £120 million of additional health spending, but only £75 million was agreed. So of the second batch of 220, you know, automatically there's a £45 million shortfall, which we have used to top up the original expectation on health funding.
Okay, well, I think I'm reasonably clear, but our colleagues may come in on that as well. Now, one of the elements of the £620 million was the personal allowance spillover dispute. And, I mean, it does seem that that's been dragging on for quite some time, and yet I think you say in your response to the committee that you're hopeful of a swift resolution. I mean, how solid is our expectation that that money will actually come in during the coming year?
The funding, my assumption is solid. It's rock solid that funding will be allocated. So both governments have agreed that a transfer is due to the Scottish Government. And they have also agreed that the methodology. So when it comes to the actual transfer, you're right, it dates back to 2017-2018. There is some disagreement about the quantum of the funding that should be transferred. We have.
Can you even give us a rough idea of what figures we're talking about there? How wide is the disagreement?
I mean, the disagreement ranges from £400 million to £1.7 billion.
Right.
So that's the range. The range is very, very significant.
Okay, that's helpful.
As you can imagine, that's part of the reason that it's been running for so long, because I believe that the Scottish Government should be properly compensated as per the methodology and as per the agreement with the UK Government that funding should be agreed. The key, though, is that the funding assumption we have made in the budget should not prejudge the outcome of the dispute resolution process, and we will continue to engage with the UK government in good faith as we progress that.
Okay, thanks very much. That's helpful to have these figures. On the point of the, you know, Liz Smith was questioning you about you've spent all the money in the budget, and yet you were able to find this extra 100 million or perhaps 200 million, you know, for business support. Can you explain to us how that happened?
In terms of last week?
Yes, and where the money is coming from?
So in terms of that £100 million, that is actually £200 million, £100 million for self-isolation, as well as £100 million for the £100 million for business support. And that is based on funding that we have basically gone through the whole budget to identify whether portfolios can contribute or allocate additional funding of anywhere in the budget. So, for example, my own budget was seeking to identify funding, and there has been identified funding from other portfolios. So it's based on looking right across the board and identifying funding on a portfolio by portfolio basis for the for that £200 million.
Okay, thanks for that. Moving on to a different area in the forecasting and the Scottish Fiscal Commission and so on making forecasts. I mean, clearly there's a challenge if the OBR forecasts the UK economy to be growing considerably faster and obviously the tax take than the Scottish Fiscal Commission do. And Spice gave us some comparisons. I mean, the OBR is forecasting 6% and SFC 3.8%. But actually, when you look at some of the other forecasts, the Bank of England's at 5%, NIESR 4.7%, and Fraser Valander for Scotland 4.8%. So, I mean, the OBR appears to be a bit of an outlier in being quite optimistic about the growth levels, and that could be causing our budget a problem. Do you think there's a difference that the OBR are being overly optimistic and the SFC are being a bit more cautious?
I mean, it's for forecasters to determine themselves, obviously, as per the methodology, and I wouldn't want to get into the territory of criticising the methodology that any forecaster uses, because they are independent of government. I recently met with the OBR and I've spoken to the SFC about the need to align their methodologies as far as possible, because that obviously makes it easier for us, where if one forecaster is basing it on a far more optimistic scenario and the other one isn't, then that obviously creates a real challenge for us in terms of block grant adjustments and the overall funding that we have available to us. So, you know, there are difficulties. This year, we have tried to align the timing as far as possible in order to ensure that that's why we went so quickly after the UK government budget, to ensure that the methodologies were as aligned as possible.
Okay, thanks. You mentioned the Welsh model for the block grant adjustment, and that might be a possibility when we go through the fiscal framework review. Now, I'm not an expert in the Welsh model, but I understand that each band of income tax then gets treated separately. Is there any downside to following the Welsh model? In that, for example, say we had a year or two where the Scottish economy does better than the UK, would we kind of lose out in that scenario?
Well, I'm happy to see if any officials want to come in on this. In terms of methodologies, no methodology is completely risk-free, so there are challenges and opportunities with all the models. I think on balance, our sense right now is that we are penalised as a result of the growing gap between basically richest and poorest in the UK, which informs the fiscal framework methodology that's applied to tax. And you know, you can see that because prior to the pandemic, obviously we were seeing earnings growth. And yet there were still challenges in terms of the overall funding that was made available to us. So it's overly simplistic to say that earnings haven't been growing and therefore there is a disproportionate impact on our block grant. We have seen earnings growth in Scotland and there's still some challenges with the block grant. So I don't know if Lucy wants to come in on that. I might be unfairly putting her on the spot.
I mean, Cabinet Secretary, really just to underline what you've already said, and the issue of differences in the tax base has perhaps been more powerful in our tax performance than had been anticipated at the time the original framework was negotiated. Of course, the fiscal framework review is going to contain a range of issues that we will be negotiating with HM Treasury in the UK government, and the methodology approach will be one of them. And certainly it makes absolute sense to look at how the approach that's been taken with others, the Welsh in this case, works and see whether that would be better applied to our situation as well. So that's one element of the overall fiscal framework review, but certainly not the only one, but it's certainly one that we will be looking at with UK government during 2022.
Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you. Michelle, to follow by Douglas.
Good morning, everybody. This is a very enjoyable session so far, and thank you in particular, Cabinet Secretary, for highlighting some of the complexities around the concept of money being allocated, then drawn down and then spent, and how that expands over one financial year to the next. Of course, that's all about financial asymmetry, but I also wanted to explore our asymmetry. And I did have a chance to very quickly glance through the report from the three Davids that you mentioned earlier, options for reforming the devolved fiscal frameworks. And one of the recommendations they make is that, given, and I'm quoting, given that devolved governments cannot really exercise full control over health policy in the absence of appropriate economic support measures. They then go on to recommend a feasibility study into making furlough-type support available on a geographical basis should be urgently undertaken and published. Now, you also correctly alluded that things are moving very rapidly since some of the data came out very recently. So my question is, do you have any indication this far of thinking from UK Treasury in terms of type of financial support that could be available in terms of furlough if and when the anticipated peak of the current COVID crisis hits us potentially mid-January? Thank you.
Yes, so you're right. I think the IFS report is very helpful in terms of an independent perspective on some of the risks that we have been identifying. Right now, I have no reassurance at all about what the UK government might do in the way of either funding, additional funding, or in the way of additional flexibilities or guarantees. We do know that the UK government has made this additional £220 million available, which is not right now based on known announcements, but based on what they think might be spent between now and the end of the financial year. If the funding is less than 220 or less than the overall 440, then we will still have to repay that funding. So we still don't have a minimum guarantee, which is what the report was alluding to. In terms of the furlough point, we right now would need HMRC to work with us to make anything is specifically available on a geographical basis. Again, that is recommended and suggested by the report out this morning, but there's no sense from my perspective that there's any willingness or openness to doing that at all from the UK government.
So, you're carrying considerable risks then, which I'm not entirely sure, being a new member, that is commonly understood. And if I can just move on quickly to the medium term financial strategy, there's a number of risks that you highlight in there. One is, quoting again, fundamental changes to the operation of finance and devolved policy making as a result of the UK Internal Market Act. Now, we were hearing earlier this morning from the Scottish Parliament corporate body that they've put provision in for the scrutiny of changes triggered by that of an additional 21 jobs. So there's a real cost implication to that that they've done projections on. So in terms of that risk, have you quantified that further than what is in your report in terms of, you've highlighted the risk, but the probability of its occurrence and the implications if it occurs? Because it strikes me that the financial implications are not yet sufficiently understood, both in terms of real spend and also in terms of risk. So I wonder if you can add some further colour to that.
I mean, the risks are significant. The risks are exacerbated at a time of COVID, obviously, because you know, the medium-term financial strategy that had just been published was wouldn't have taken into account necessarily the specific impacts of Omicron. So the, you know, and I don't know the extent to which, for example, the SFC, certainly the OBR, wouldn't have taken into account. So forecasts were set pre-Omicron, and already we've had to make funding available. And I guess there's some uncertainty as to the extent to which the impact of Omicron will be felt. You know, if it ultimately leads to the need to take drastic measures further down the line, then that will have an economic impact. But it will also require us to manage the financial impact from within our own budgets. And that is a challenge. So goes back to the point of having the tools to deal with unexpected risks. You cannot, nobody, not even our forecasters, have the crystal ball required to figure out precisely how Omicron is going to unravel or other variants. And we are in a position where we are absolutely dependent on the UK government for making additional funding available. If we make that funding available within our own budget, it puts at risk our ability to come to a position of balance by the end of the financial year. And I am required to be in balance by the end of the financial year. So there are huge risks without necessarily the tools to manage that risk, which is why the period since the budget was passed has obviously been a hugely difficult and very busy period in terms of trying to figure out how we can squeeze any more funding from our own budget to help businesses. But again, I'm going to just pause and see if anybody else wants to come in on that point of managing risk. I think it's probably unlikely, but it was just to add any more flavour.
It looks like there's no takers. Just one more question following on from that, from risks. You've correctly highlighted some of the implications around resource funding, but in terms of, you also highlight capital funding for the future, and particularly risks to the NIM in terms of local and regional infrastructure. So I suppose from a risk perspective of that, that then directly links into economic growth and productivity thrown into that pot as well. Have you had a chance to give any more flavour to that risk where there's direct investment by the UK government in local and regional infrastructure? You may not, but it's just a question off the back of that, since we've been focusing on resource.
Yeah, I mean, capital is almost like an opposite risk, which is about capital having to be managed over a longer time period because of the risks of COVID. So that's where you get into the territory of trying to figure out how you carry forward, carry forward funding from year to year. Last year, we saw it quite acutely where, as I've already said, in the last quarter, we saw a lockdown. So we then had to figure out how not to breach the limits of the reserve drawdown and ensure that all of that funding was still available to us in subsequent years. You know, basically, local government can carry forward more funding, technically, than we can. And so the risk is to ensure that money can still be managed and still be drawn down.
Well, that seems ridiculous, but concludes my questions, convener. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Michelle. It'll be Douglas next, followed by Ross.
Thanks, convener, and good afternoon now, Cabinet Secretary. I just want to pick up on a question that John Mason had asked earlier, Cabinet Secretary, about the 100 million for business support and 100 million for self-isolation. I think you said that came from portfolio underspends. So I guess the question I have was there any, you know, did you stop at 200 million, or was there any more underspends that can be used for other things as well?
Thanks, and that allows me just to clarify, it's not from underspend, it's from a budget that was allocated. So for example, in my own portfolio, budget that had been allocated for some schemes and initiatives, which we will now need to manage over a longer time period. So it's not all the funding was allocated, and the same applies to other portfolios. So, for example, in the health space, this was money that was allocated. So all the funding right now, this year in particular, we are managing a particularly challenging budget, and that is demonstrated by the fact that there's no money in next year's budget based on an assumption of carry forward. In other words, we don't assume at this point in the financial year to have any underspend that can be carried forward, because we are truly maxed out on every budget line. So it came from a whole host of different sources, largely where we have had to perhaps phase things over a longer time period.
So I guess, Cabinet Secretary, did that exercise stop at 200 million, or was there more money that could be allocated from that exercise?
So the First Minister will set out to this afternoon alongside the Omicron figures, as well as the next steps. She will set out what more we might be able to do for business. Most of that is informed by a figure that we're using of about £175 million from the UK government on Sunday night, and that's the 220 less the £45 million that was already factored in. So that will be factored in this afternoon. Any other funding that we make available right now is just made at some degree of risk, because it will need to be managed over the next 3 or 4 months. So it's quite late on in the financial year. And at this point in a financial year, most of the funding is either contractually or legally already agreed. So, for example, it's for salaries, it's for local government, it's for areas that it's for legal commitments to do with transport. Very difficult to free up. So anywhere where we have discretion is about phasing it rather than either stopping something or delivering underspend. It's quite unlikely that there will be any underspend at this late point in the financial year.
Okay, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I think you probably expect me to ask about local government. So, on page 12 of the budget, it says there's a real term resource increase of 4.4% to local government. But when you look at the briefing note that we've received from COSLA, they claim a cut of approximately 100 million to the revenue funded for councils compared to 21-22. And also, capital claimed there's a 7.2% increase, but COSLA claim that that's a flat cash. So it's really just to understand, Cabinet Secretary, who do we believe when it comes to local government finance? Is it COSLA or is it the Scottish Government?
I would always advise people to believe the numbers rather than necessarily anybody else's take on the numbers. What the numbers will show you, and I know Douglas Lumsden will know his way around the local government settlement probably more than anybody else. But I would differentiate, because this is what COSLA does, between the core budget and the overall settlement. In terms of the core budget, which is protected in cash terms, I don't recognise the £100 million figure that local government is using. They wrote to me recently about that £100 million. I'm trying to get underneath it, because my understanding is they are saying it's for Scottish Government priorities, but I don't recognise the figure. As far as I'm concerned, if you compare last year's core budget to this year's core budget, you will see protection in cash terms. Of course, the argument could then be made that it doesn't take into account the impact of inflation, and I can't inflation-proof any part of the Scottish Government's budget, such as the nature of inflation right now. The other part to this, of course, is that there is real terms growth to the settlement. And I think Douglas Lumsden would probably agree with me, I'd hope, that when it comes to joint priorities, education is a joint priority, social care is a joint priority, and there's significant additional funding for health and social care integration, which COSLA don't calculate as part of their core budget, but where you see an additional, significant additional spend on health and social care and a significant additional spend on teachers and support staff. And of course, that also includes funding for free school meals and for curriculum and music tuition charges and expanded school clothing grants. So I hope I've tried to be as fair as possible in distinguishing the budget as COSLA does, but I certainly don't recognise that £100 million that COSLA references.
Mm-hmm. I guess looking at the figures that COSLA has provided, a big piece of that £100 million is the employer's national insurance contribution increase. They've calculated as £70 million. And I guess they would complain that they haven't been compensated for that, while potentially areas like the NHS have been compensated. So would that be a fair reflection on that?
So I have not compensated the NHS for national insurance contributions. What the NHS have chosen to do is to use part of their budget for national insurance contributions. And that obviously is an inflationary impact. In terms of the budget that we received, there isn't, as it were, a line in the budget that we received which is for national insurance contributions. So I've taken the overall budget, I've allocated it, and most all public bodies are being expected to absorb the national insurance contributions.
Okay, that's helpful, thank you. I'm thinking about the local government budget, and I'm thinking about, you know, what the Deputy First Minister told us at this committee not long ago about, you know, the shift to prevention. And I guess that's difficult when local governments see their budget being restricted in this way. And I'm thinking about the obesity report that we've seen this week. And I guess the inequality that brings when potentially local governments will be closing swimming pools and sports facilities. But, you know, if people can afford it, then they can still go to private clubs. So I'm just trying to think how we address the inequality around that, when local government budgets are being squeezed by the amount we're seeing?
I think it's a very fair question. And again, it's where I go back to what I think is an unfair distinction between core and overall settlement. Because whilst, you know, in the figures that we're seeing from COSLA, they are not factoring in the overall settlement, a lot of what's in the overall settlement is very much in the prevention space. So I know if more money goes in social care, then we are relieving pressure in acute health centres, which is why I fought very hard in this budget to ensure that a fair share of the health and social care consequentials were actually going to local government, because local government deserves a fair share of the overall health and social care consequentials. It's not just health consequentials, it's health and social care consequentials, and they deserve a fair share. And the same goes for, let's take something, you talked about obesity, which I think is a really good example. You take something like free school meals, you know, local government, I know, are as committed as we are to ensuring that children growing up in poverty have a nutritious diet. And I know it relieves pressure in other parts of the health system if we do that. So that's why I think it's very difficult. You can't just ignore the overall settlement. And once you include the overall settlement, including enhanced funding for free school meals, it's a cash increase of about £917.9 million or 7.9%. And that's a real terms increase of 5.1%. So do you think, as part of the overall settlement, we need to be clear that these are shared priorities? I don't think it gets away from some of the pressures within the local government settlement. But then every single one of my cabinet secretary colleagues and every public body is telling me about the pressures they face. So I don't think any part of the public sector is cushioned from some of the budgetary pressures.
Okay, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. I just want to move on to something else. It's on page 115 of the budget pack. As a new member, I'm maybe just not quite understanding this, but it says in here the city deal funding is shown as £100 million that's been included in the Scottish Government spending plans for 2022-23, but that figure doesn't seem to have been included in previous years. maybe just give a bit of an explanation on that, Cabinet Secretary?
Yeah, and I will also ask if anybody wants to come in from officials in terms of whether it's been in previous years or not, which is what you're comparing. Obviously, the City Deal funding, just for a bit of colour, is quite a unique funding mechanism, because the UK government basically gives us a lump sum at the beginning of the financial year, and then we manage the payments to City Deal partners as part of the City Deal funding. So, you know, I don't know if any official wants to come in. I'm not aware of how it compares with previous years, because I'm not conscious of that. But I think it's just important to identify that City Deal funding is outside the Barnett formula. So it's kind of factored in a different way to other funding, because it's money that comes straight in and money that goes straight out to partners. I don't see anybody wanting to come in, but that's probably the closest to an answer.
Okay, maybe you can get some clarification after, because as I say, in previous years it doesn't show, and it's really just to check whether that, you know, if that's money coming in as part of the spending, I guess it has to be allocated out, and I just couldn't see in the budget where it was being allocated out, straight out again, to local authorities, I guess. So I'll move on to next question, Cabinet Secretary. It's around the North East and Moray Transition Fund. You know, we can see from the budget there's 20 million in capital funding for next year for that. Are you able to give us any more details on what that 20 million is going to be spent on yet?
Yeah, and so this is specifically for the North East, isn't it? The North East transition, and
that's yes, the North East and Moray. Yes.
Yeah. Thanks. So that £20 million is, I think, part of obviously the £500 million. In terms of how it's being spent, you will appreciate, and I certainly have it in my inbox, quite a number of local partners want to have a say on how it's spent. So what we've said is that we are willing to engage with them on the specifics of how it should be spent. It will be spent on helping with the transition. But you know, if I go back to last year, when it came to an agreement with the Liberal Democrats at the time for £15 million of additional funding, we then engaged particularly with One North East on how to best allocate that £15 million. And I would want to be in a similar position with the transition funding to engage. So we've put it on the face of it, and now we're engaging intensively to figure out the best way of deploying it.
So do we have any timetable of when that plans will come forward?
As soon as possible. It needs to be spent in this next financial year. So we're about 4 months away, I suppose, give or take, 3 months now, away from the end of the financial year. So my view would be it has to be determined in order to start being spent fairly soon into the next financial year.
Okay, thank you. And one last question, Cabinet Secretary. It's around the A96. We've heard plans about dualling between Inverness and Nairn. Is it still the commitment to fully dual the A96 by 2030?
So in terms of the funding in this year's budget, there is funding in this year's budget in order to continue to invest in our key trunk roads. You will appreciate that the current plan is to fully dual the A96 route between Inverness and Aberdeen. We have agreed to conduct a transparent, evidence-based review of the programme that will report by the end of 2022. And you know, all road projects, including the A96, are subject to detailed review and assessment. We remain committed to making much-needed improvements to the A96, but I think we need to let that review run its course.
Okay, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, Ross, and followed by Daniel.
Thanks, Convener, and apologies, I had to step away for a couple of moments there to take a call. If any of the questions that I'm about to ask have already been covered by a colleague, please do just interject and tell me to check the official report later. Cabinet Secretary, in response to John Mason's line of question around the initial £220 million that was announced by the UK government in response to Omicron last week, you clarified that that was money that the Scottish Government had budgeted for in next year's budget. I just check if that was committed to other priorities, or is it all being used for the same COVID-specific purpose, and it's essentially it's being spent in exactly the same way, it's just now being spent at an earlier date than it was otherwise going to?
Are you asking from the UK government perspective? What the UK government would normally do is that they would make announcements, and then they would confirm the final allocation in January or February. So what they've done is confirm the final allocations in December rather than January or February. So in a sense, the spending power, there's a fundamental difference between cash flow and budgeting. So once you know the budget's coming, it's our responsibility to manage cash flow. So the funding doesn't come necessarily into our bank account for us to then draw down. That will happen before the end of the financial year, probably happen in January or February. But now we know that that budget is definitive, we can then, as part of our overall budget, choose how it is spent. But the key is that we already thought it was coming, so we had already budgeted for it in our overall budget plans.
Yes, apologies, I probably didn't word that question very well. What I'm trying to confirm is if you are still intending to spend it for the same purpose as you had originally budgeted for just now at an earlier date, or if it's now going to be deployed differently to how you had previously budgeted for it.
I don't think it's going to be deployed differently, because if it's deployed differently, it just creates a big hole somewhere else. So if I move that money, all it does is give me a headache elsewhere, because it's not new money. Basically spending it in a new way would just create a bigger hole elsewhere.
Thanks. And the £200 million that you announced, I think, again, last week for business support and self-isolation support, you clarified this morning that that's being contributed to from across various portfolios. Could you just confirm what the breakdown of that is from our portfolios contributing this on the basis of underspends that they were projecting, or have other priorities been paused or cancelled so the money can be redeployed for this purpose?
It's certainly not on the basis of underspend, because this year's budget is particularly tight. The funding comes from a whole range of different sources, so it's painstakingly built up of funding that was otherwise earmarked for different initiatives and different schemes. So in my own budget, there was elements around employability. In the health budget, there was areas around business that they were intending to undertake. And obviously, these things still need to be done. So they will need to be managed over a longer time frame rather than things being stopped completely. But I think we will get into the territory of things having to be stopped completely if there's no more funding forthcoming.
Thanks. And is that breakdown of where the money's been contributed from, is that available yet anywhere, or could that be provided to the committee?
No, and it wouldn't be anyway, because it's all to do with our internal management of budgets. So the key is the autumn budget revision, obviously, which just passed, spring budget revision, where there will be a transparent accounting for every penny, particularly around transfers. So you will, in that point, see transfers from where the budget was earmarked to where it will be spent. But at a time of quite considerable flux, it would just be a snapshot in time. And so I would point you in the direction of the spring budget revision, not least because there may be additional announcements tonight. So, you know, as soon as you've published one thing, it's out of date. So the spring budget revision will be the point at which you can see all the allocations and the transfers, and obviously hold us accountable for the decisions that we've made.
Thanks. And going back to, I believe it was Liz Smith's line of questioning around the Auditor General's report looking into the 2021 underspend that was carried over into 2021-22, and you've explained the reasons why and for what purposes that was. To what extent are you expecting a similar level of underspend being carried forward from this year into the 2022-23 budget?
Well, I'm discovering that in COVID times, an hour is a very long time, and therefore anything could happen. I go back to this time last year, where the UK government told us there would be no additional pennies, and within, I think it was almost an hour, there was, I think it, from memory, it was about £400 million was announced. So, you know, there are no guarantees, I don't think, at this point in time. but I find it very, very difficult to believe that there will be much, if any, resource spending review based on the, sorry, resource underspend based on what I know of the budget right now. And if there was to be, then we would have factored it into the carry forward and would have baked it into the assumptions for next year's budget, which we haven't done for the first time in probably 2 years.
Turning to a completely different issue, the public sector pay policy, for the first time this year, that includes a commitment to pilot the four-day working week, which I know will be welcomed by a number of unions. Now, on the face of it, there's not a significant immediate financial impact of that, that the principle of the four-day working week or reductions in the working weeks on the basis of reducing the number of hours worked for a similar level of pay. But how are you accounting for those pilot projects as part of the coming year's pay policy?
Yeah, so those pilot projects will require to be funded, so they will have a financial impact. We had previously set out in our manifesto an overall quantum of about £10 million over the course of the Parliament for pilots. And so I think taking forward the process this year, obviously working with public bodies, it will be dependent on the nature of the pilot. So obviously public bodies will vary in size, they'll vary in the average wage. And so I think we need to work with them to understand what the financial implications will be. But we are committed to taking forward trials this year.
Thanks very much. That's all from me at the moment, Convener.
Okay, Daniel, you're on.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm almost tempted to start by asking questions as to what text messages the Cabinet Secretary's had, if she's saying an hour is a very long time at the moment. But I won't ask her to divulge. I would be quite interested in actually going back to some of the points that both the Convener and Liz Smith were raising about the Fiscal Commission's report, and maybe just asking to extrapolate. Certainly, and this is a question I asked the Fiscal Commission when they were in front of us, you know, looking at figures 2.3 and 2.4 in their report, and I won't expect the Cabinet Secretary to recall what they say, but they set out the tax net position and also forecasting Social Security. If you combine the numbers in 26-27 for both of those lines, the net tax position is a deficit of $355 million, and Social Security is $764 million in additional commitments and spend. That would indicate a £1.2 billion sum that would need to be found within other budgets if you accept those projections. I'm just wondering, does the Cabinet Secretary accept those projections? And I accept that this is beyond this budget, probably beyond the spending review in the new year, but it's certainly within the horizon of this Parliament, and that would suggest some quite difficult in-line changes between budget lines in the coming years. Is that a fair analysis of those forecasts?
Well, if I start with income tax, and bear in mind, I have no choice but to accept SFC forecasts and figures. So I'm obliged to only spend within SFC forecasts. So in a sense, whether I accept or don't is almost moot. But when it comes to income tax, obviously, the final position on the performance of income tax revenues next year, so the year that we're setting the budget for, will only be known once outturn data is published in 2024. So my issue in next year's budget is to manage the reconciliation from 2 years ago, which is actually is certainly one of the lowest reconciliations that we've had to manage. But I think this goes back to two points which I've made already. One is that managing budgets over a long-term period requires you to set multi-year spending reviews, and the spending review, it will need to factor that in. So the spending review will only be able to spend what funding we expect to receive. That includes grants from the UK government, as well as income tax forecasts. So, you know, we will need to spend. Once outturn data is then published, we will need to manage any reconciliations. And in the past, forecasts of what those reconciliations are have nearly always been revised multiple times. The best way of dealing with reconciliations is, of course, through resource borrowing for forecast error. And I think it confirms the point that we've been making through the fiscal framework discussions, that we need borrowing for forecast error to recognise the levels of volatility, where in one year you can have £309 million, in another year you can have £14 million of forecast error, and you need to manage both of them. So the borrowing powers are designed to sort of smooth that path, that trajectory, and also to avoid us having to use real spending power for forecast error, because that's what it is. It is forecast error when it comes to the reconciliation. The last point just on Social Security is, you know, that is also another challenge because it's a demand-led budget. So we need to manage that. And we have taken a slightly different approach in Scotland, which is to, as far as possible, promote uptake of Social Security benefits, because we think that people have a right to Social Security benefits, and we will need to manage that. Finally, though, you will tell me, and I will agree with it, that the best way of dealing with all of this is economic growth, shared prosperity, fairness, and that won't single-handedly be delivered through a budget. You know, a budget is a list of spending commitments, but actually, this is as much about policy as it is about spend.
I'll come on to that point in a moment, but let me agree with it that what we should all be focused on is essentially getting more people earning money, and those people are already earning money, earning more. I think that is something that we can all agree on, and that happening as fairly as possible. But just back to the point. I mean, I understand the point, and I understand the complexity of the reconciliations. The mechanism block grant adjustments is sort of simple when you see it on a flow chart, but actually looking at the different time lags is complicated. But what you answered, I felt, was more about what happens within a given year. And really what I'm asking is that broad trend and that broad envelope that will need to be addressed over the next 3, 4, 5 years. And I recognise that you cannot predict the precise numbers that will drop out of those streams, but the overall picture painted by the Fiscal Commission is one that will place downward pressure on budget lines that are essentially not Social Security, does it not?
We will need to manage that. I suppose there's not really any other answer but that we will need to manage that within our resource spending review. Come back to me if I'm misunderstanding, but the nature of Social Security is very different from income tax, because Social Security is demand led. So I need to meet that demand. I can't say halfway through the year, sorry, I've run out of money, and therefore, so I will need to manage the demand, and we will need to take intelligent decisions about the nature of Social Security to meet that. But I fear from your face that perhaps I'm misunderstanding the question.
No. I kind of agree. I mean, I think basically your income tax and the Social Security bills are things which are in some manner or means out with your control. And if they are putting pressure on your budget, they're going to force you to manage budget lines elsewhere, which are in your control. And that is going to be the dominant feature of the comprehensive spending review, and indeed the budgets through this parliament. That's really what I'm trying to get at.
Absolutely. You've hit the nail on the head. So we can't get away from how important this resource spending review is. I've got to manage a trajectory of spend. In each budget, I can almost manage a snapshot of spend. This year, to get from A to Z, how do we plan? The spending review will allow us to do two things. One, it will allow us to spend over multiple years, which can drive reform as well as manage budgets. But I think it's very difficult to drive reform over a year-to-year basis. It just, you end up budgeting for the immediate challenges in front of you rather than budgeting for the challenges in 3 years' time. but also it will require us to say, right, in 2 years' time, we expect, or actually the SFC are forecasting, Social Security spend to be, you know, this figure. And therefore, we need to manage other budget lines on that trajectory of getting them to a position where we're not dealing with, for example, huge cuts. We are dealing with a plan that gets us there. But it's not going to be easy.
Yes. I rather suspect that if Douglas Lumsden was coming after me in his questions, he would reflect that multi-year budgets and predictability is something that local government would like just as much as the Scottish government. But I'll move on. I mean, on this point around growth and especially looking at income tax growth, that is, was in a sense the big surprise from the Fiscal Commission, that the reconciliations were I think a lot more kind of detrimental than we were. Well, they weren't. I think many of us were expecting them to be positive rather than negative. But looking at the Fiscal Commission's report in figures 3.16, 3.18 and 3.19, looking at income tax change, and again, this was, I think, touched on by Liz Smith, but I think it's worthy of further interrogation. You know, looking at the change in PAYE, both in terms of mean pay, but also total pay, it strikes me there's more going on than has been alluded to. So first of all, I think some of the analysis that was presented by the government was that, you know, as ever, Scotland is lagging behind London and the South East. Now, this analysis would suggest that it's actually significantly worse than that. It's not just London and the South East. And you know, and critically on some of the points you were mentioning in terms of upper pay bands, those are points that just as equally would apply to, or one would expect would apply, other regions such as the northeast of England, you know, such as the northwest, such as Wales. And yet on all of these measures, or most of these measures, Scotland is lagging. Now, I'd be interested in your analysis of that. But critically, one of the things that was highlighted by Professor Graham Roy, amongst others, were labour participation rates, both amongst the younger cohorts and older cohorts. Is that not a big problem? Do we not need to pay much more attention to labour participation, making sure that we are actually putting people into the right things, especially at a time where there are labour shortages, which a half full version or view of that is that's almost an opportunity to get people into better paid jobs?
So lots in that question, and I'm just going to also flag that I will ask Lucy O'Carroll to come in at some point. But I think we do need to get beyond the headlines of what this means and what it doesn't mean. So one of the things that you would automatically think it might mean is that earnings aren't growing in Scotland. But earnings have grown in Scotland every year since tax devolution prior to the pandemic. So there's quite clearly a challenge around the fiscal framework. So let's park that, because I've already talked about it, and I think it's been made clear already that where you see stronger earnings growth elsewhere, it still means that our budget is being reduced. And you talked about the northeast of England. They of course don't have a tax devolution, so even though there will be an impact on their position, and we know that just more generally there are some inequalities. We also know that there are particular sectors in Scotland that have been hit hard by COVID, that have been, and I have already talked about oil and gas, where some of the highest earners are in the oil and gas sector in Scotland. The oil and gas sector has been through an incredibly tumultuous time, and we've seen big challenges. So I think we do need to understand more around that. But let me come on to the solutions, because you talked about things like labour participation. And this is where I'm going to bring in Lucy, because one of the keys in all of this is to understand precisely where the challenges are in the Scottish economy and where the challenges aren't. You talked about participation. Now, there are some difficulties in economic activity, which we are looking at in terms of how do we get more people into work. There are good reason why many people are classified as economically inactive. They're either carers, they're stay-at-home parents, or they're students. But there's also another cohort who are long-term sick or otherwise. And one of the reasons that we've invested quite intensively in things like No One Left Behind is to try and bring these people closer to the labour market. But it's an incredibly expensive process because individuals need a lot of wraparound help and care. But I'm going to stop, if you don't mind, and just invite Lucy in, because she is the expert on all things tax related, particularly getting to the nub of this problem.
Thanks, Ms. Forbes. Happy to come in. On the issue of labour market participation and its implications for our tax take, as Cabinet Secretary has already referred to, there are a variety of reasons for people not participating in the labour market. So neither being neither seeking work nor classifying themselves as having a job. And when it's at the younger end of the age spectrum, that need not be a problem economically because it is young people who are studying, and arguably they will come into more productive work as a result and deal with our productivity issues that have been discussed already in the committee. The older end of the age range, it does seem to be and have been for many years in Scotland more of a challenge, particularly in males aged over 55, having health problems and exiting the labour force early relative to their counterparts in the rest of the UK. That could be partly a legacy of deindustrialisation in Scotland. These things take many years to work through the data. And the efforts that are being made by the government to address these issues, particularly in this older age group, they take time to develop, they take time to enact, and they take time to bear fruit. And when you are operating within a fiscal framework that tends to run its on annual terms rather than multi-year terms, then there's a challenge there and a time inconsistency between the budget process within which you're operating and the outcomes that you wish to attain. And overall, that means for our income tax take that in order to build, to reinforce, to improve upon the tax base in Scotland, we need to be addressing these longer term problems, and that we have that challenge there of managing within this short term fiscal framework. And that's why the multi-year spending review will help us frame this more in a more effective multi-year context, and also address the issues in the labour market and therefore the issues in income tax as well.
Thank you. I mean, forgive me, but I think in a sense, in the response to that, we have just sort of continued the description of the problem rather than actually providing analysis. I mean, again, if we look at figure 3.19, and absolutely, we see the particular problem in northeastern Scotland, and I think that's very understandable in terms of oil and gas. And by the way, just directing this more at the Cabinet Secretary rather than Lucy Driscoll. But you know, the issue we have is that no Scottish region is performing better than the UK average, and indeed no Scottish region is performing better than Wales or Northern Ireland, and those are devolved administrations. And given that we have the levers here, one would hope that Scotland as a whole would perform better than UK average. But at the very least, one would hope that at least some Scottish regions would perform better than the UK average, but they don't. And indeed, many of the regions that I'm identifying here have exactly the same demographic problems that we do, precisely the same issues with deindustrialisation and the legacy of that. So why? What's the analysis? Why is Scotland lagging? And more importantly, why is every single Scottish region lagging the UK average and indeed the other devolved nations? Is that not a really critical question that the Scottish Government has to have a handle on?
And when you say lagging, can you just tell me what metric you're using? Are you talking about
3.19? So this is the total. No, this is a crude aggregate picture of total pay growth between February 2020 and September 2021.
So this is basically earnings growth.
Yeah, but I mean, frankly, you can look at the other cuts as well. So the three other, the two other perspectives, and it's a roughly the same picture.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of earnings growth, earnings growth has increased in Scotland every year since tax devolution prior to the pandemic. So earnings growth, and I'm sure in, I don't have the analysis to hand, but in previous budgets, the analysis that we have been able to share as part of the budget in terms of earnings growth, and in some cases tax growing at a faster rate. I think there are three things I would point to. Now, you will say this is describing the problem, but I think you can't find solutions unless you describe the problem. The first is the way in which certain sectors have been hit by COVID. I think the second is the way in which particularly higher earners have been affected by downturn in oil and gas. And thirdly, by what you called participation and economic activity, which is a legacy issue. How do we solve all that? Well, here's three answers. One, we bring people more closer to the job, to the labour market. We need to get them into work in the first place. And I would point to initiatives like No One Left Behind to try and get them in. But these are relatively recent initiatives. These are not initiatives that have been running for many, many years and failed to deliver. These are relatively new initiatives that are specifically targeting the problems that we're talking about. And secondly, from an economic perspective, we invest in high growth sectors. You know, where are our high growth sectors? What are the sectors that are going to create those high paid wages, or at least ensure that everybody is paid the real living wage and above? And that is particularly in the green economy, but it's also in tech, in life sciences, in the areas where we have strengths. And the third thing, I think, is to make sure that we are doing the analysis on a regional basis. So there are quite clearly areas in Scotland where wage growth is higher, where we have seen there are more higher rate taxpayers than elsewhere. So how do we ensure that areas like the area that the convener represents, and who is at pains to regularly tell me about the need to invest in the west of Scotland, how do we ensure that these areas are not left behind and we only focus on the Edinburghs and the Aberdeens? How are we creating jobs there? So those are three examples. They are works in progress. We haven't nailed it yet, but I think we all have an interest in ensuring that they work.
Indeed, which is the only reason I pressed the point. It is highly important. I'm very conscious of time, but if I can ask just one last question, if I may, and it's a relatively broad one. I just would like to get the Cabinet Secretary's response to Stephen Boyd's comments, which were issued with the audited accounts last week, where he said, in reference to the COVID funding in 2021, while there is some high-level details about how this money was used, the government needs to be more proactive, open and transparent with the provision of this important detail. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary for a kind of a response to that? And critically, it strikes me this is a balancing act between business as usual, immediate response to COVID and recovery, and that is difficult, but to do that effectively, you need that transparency, not just in terms of what you have spent in the past, but an ongoing basis. And I ask, so can I ask, in addition to a response to Stephen Boyd's comments, how is the government going to track that COVID spend between those sort of essentially those three poles?
Yeah, thanks. And I heard the comments, and it reminded me of previous exchanges that we have had. I mean, it's just worth saying, which you'll indulge me, that the accounts did attract, again, an unqualified audit opinion from the Auditor General. So, you know, I think that's a sign of strength when it comes to the accounts. How do we track it? It's really difficult. And I'll be open and honest with you about how difficult it is when it comes to the moving parts. You know, we have seen, I think, a perfect example in the last 2 weeks of how complex this is. Funding announcements being made, Scottish Government saying it's not new spending power, new announcements being made, Scottish Government saying, well, some of it's new spending power, and then us setting out how we're going to spend it. The nature of our budgets at the moment are incredibly fluid. And I would love if we actually had a bit more of a mature debate in the Parliament about the nature of our budgets. As soon as I made the announcement about additional funding, the first calls were, well, what have you cut? With people ready to lambast what we had cut. The nature of a budget is that things go up and things go down. And I think we had a more mature discussion about it. I am open to ideas and recommendations of what we should publish. Right, last week on Budget Day, we published a medium-term financial strategy, five-year outlook. We published public sector pay policy. We published our ambitions for tax. And we also published the budget document. So that is all proactive, that's ahead of time. And then we published the accounts. And I think this year the accounts have received far more attention than they nearly ever do. The outturn statement very seldom receives much attention, if anything, but the outturn statement tells you what we actually spent, not just what we said we're going to spend. So I think there's a lot of documents out there. I think, unfortunately, headlines emerge which are not always based on the hard fact within the documents, but perhaps on political takes. And I'm not targeting at the member who asked me the question, because I always know he does this in a very intelligent and carefully considered way. If there's more that we can publish, that's fine. But anything more we will publish, is not permanent. It's a snapshot that will be out of date by the time of the next announcement, because that's the nature of budgets. And I wouldn't want to draw links with, being a shopkeeper, but unexpected things happen, and your budgets are only as strong as their ability to forecast perfectly, and none of us can forecast perfectly. Long story short, if there's more that I can publish, I will happily publish. But in terms of our ongoing budget management, that's really difficult. And it's why we have two points in time, the autumn budget revision, the spring budget revision, where we nail down where the budgets are at, rather than, as it were, a running commentary on the nature of the budgets internally.
I think that one other thing I would just add is I think there's also a question mark about the timings of some of these things. I think that could help the maturity of the debate, and I'm happy to discuss that in the future. But that is helpful. And I could go on, but in the interest of time, I will finish there, Convener.
Thank you very much, Deputy Convener. And I did say that members could come in a second time, but we've got no one asking questions. And Cabinet Secretary, you've given us more than 2 hours of your time, which we greatly appreciate. So I'm actually going to thank you for your evidence today. I'd like to wish the Cabinet Secretary and the team and all the committee a Merry Christmas and Happy New Year when it comes. And our next meeting is scheduled for Tuesday, 11th of January. And as that was the final item, I now close this meeting. So thank you very much, everyone. See you on the other side. Bye.